Hello, ladies and gents. Welcome to the second episode and Beyond the Bullshit. And a big hello to Ozymandias, our guest, and a big shout out to also my co-host, Joseph. Do you want to say a word, Joseph?
Good evening, everybody. Just want to say one thing. Continue your support to wear hats indoors and end discrimination. Hat lives matter. That is all.
Hat lives matter. There you go. You heard it first here on our show. Save the hats, people. Save the hats. Okay, so I mean, this show today is not going to be one of these like deep philosophical thinking things because, yeah, it's just not. But it is going to be situated around our good friend Ozzy and how he came to the conclusions he did, and because we all know him as a good philosophical brain in that regard. So I thought it'd be a great idea to have him on the show by himself. But I did thank you for coming on impromptu last time, and I kept them up for ages, so I do apologize to your wife for that. It's probably my
That's
fault.
okay.
So yeah, Ozzy, if you don't mind, just introduce yourself and we'll kick it off from there.
Sure. Well, my name is my handle, my online handle is Ozymandias Ramses the Second. It's a handle I've used for many years because I've been involved in the great debate community online, not on YouTube or Google Plus, but on IRC and other venues, other online forums, for many, many years. And presently, I'm a YouTuber. I'm involved in the Google Plus community. I make videos about the great debate. Most of my videos are centered on specifically philosophical questions, where I try to clarify theological and philosophical concepts. Because my background is in contemporary analytic philosophy, my area of specialization was epistemology, and I have an interest also in the philosophy of science, philosophy of mind, and the philosophy of language. What else can I say about myself? I'm 50 years old. I'm Canadian, and I'm a recurring panelist on a number of online shows that have to do with the Great Debate community. First and foremost, the Magic Sandwich Show. I've been on that one for quite a long time now. Deeper Than Dogma. Most recently, I've been participating regularly with Gary Edwards and the History Revolution, two prominent YouTubers in a show called Deep Thought. I also devoted a lot of time and still occasionally devote some time to appearing on The Place, which is a New Covenant Group show.
Okay.
So that's mostly what I do is I do hangouts on various shows. I appear in just ordinary hangouts with my friends in the community, and I have my own videos on all of this.
Okay,
And
that's good stuff.
for some reason, I have to, I mean, I'm gonna have to apologize. For some reason, my webcam just keeps spontaneously going on and off. I'm not sure if it's a
Yeah.
bandwidth issue or not, but forgive me. I'm not turning it on and off. It just spontaneously goes off, and when it does, I have to turn it on again. So if I seem to disappear, that's the reason.
He's trying to give you subversive epileptic fits. That's what he's trying
Yeah,
to
gonna try to induce a seizure in someone with me flashing on and off. Yeah.
do
Okay.
have a, I just do have a quick question for you, Ozzy, before we get into the whole philosophical nitty-gritty. Would you describe your endeavors, shall we say, on YouTube and the various platforms you've been on as fruitful? Like, have there been good, I guess, results that have come from your interactions over the years?
Yeah, well, I haven't been on involved in the community on Google Plus and YouTube for very long, just a little over a year and a half, perhaps, if that. Yeah, I think it's been productive and fruitful. I've certainly found it very enjoyable. I've found it personally edifying. I've learned a lot. But I think, yeah, I think I've changed some minds here and there. I think in some cases I've shifted the conversation in a way that I thought was more productive. I think when I joined the community, there was a lot of people sort of spinning their wheels, talking about presuppositionalism an awful lot. I think a lot of people in the atheistic community, for those who don't know, by the way, I'm an atheist. But there were a lot of people in the atheist community, I think, were struggling with presuppositionalism because it's a purely philosophical argument. And a lot of atheists have sort of cut their teeth and gone to school on the scientific questions, questions of cosmology, questions of evolution, and stuff like that. They're used to arguing with fundamentalists and religious biblical inerrantists and that sort of thing. And they're used to attacking and countering these apologetics from a scientific perspective. But a lot of people were struggling with presuppositionalism, and that's sort of what inspired me to get involved in the great debate, was I thought, you know, I think I can contribute to something to this here, because I know a little something about this. And so I think I was able to impress upon a number of people that philosophical questions that are being raised by presuppositionalists are actually serious and important questions, and are not to be dismissed, and that there aren't easy answers to these questions. And we can own up to this and admit these difficulties without having to pretend that if we don't happen to have an answer to the question of an infinite justificatory regress problem, like how do you know, et cetera, that therefore the other person who's asking the questions somehow has some answer just because they invoke a god as the guarantor of their beliefs. So I think I sort of injected myself into the conversation there, and I think I've actually made some inroads there. I've changed some minds there. I've helped people understand that whole apologetic and how to counter it a little better. I think also the whole question of how we should understand and define atheism, what is, you know, who has the burden of justification, that sort of thing. I think I've had some things to say there that have caused a number of people to take pause and rethink their positions. So yeah, I think it's been productive. I think I've had some measure of accomplishment in that I've gotten some people to sort of rethink things. And that's always good. I mean, I'm not really agitating for atheism. My enemy is not theism per se. My enemy is irrationality and dogmatism. And if I can encourage people to be more skeptical, to up their game, to learn some more critical thinking skills, then I think naturally people will move away from dogmatism and superstition and religiosity and fundamentalism and religiosity in general, and then will move in the direction of agnosticism and atheism. So I think atheism, you sort of get atheism for free. You get it as a byproduct. You don't have to push or agitate for atheism. I don't try to sell or recommend atheism. I only try to recommend that people up their game intellectually and try to apply some good critical thinking. And I think that will tend to take people in the direction of atheism. I'm certainly not someone who thinks that atheists have cornered the market on critical thinking and reasonableness and rationality. That's absolutely not true. I don't think that atheists are in the main better critical thinkers or more reasonable. You know, they're not. I think that's a conceit that we like to tell ourselves in this movement. But I do think that if you do apply those tools, that they will take you in that direction. But people arrive at their theism, and they arrive at their agnosticism, and they arrive at their atheism, and their igtheism, and whatever other positions. But very often they arrive at them for bad reasons. And so just because you have found yourself in a position where the people who share that position with you like to take credit for being critical thinkers and free thinkers and rationalists, you're not necessarily in that position. You don't get a PhD in critical thinking just because you shed your fundamentalism, for instance.
Yeah. Right. Well, I was, that's actually a very good point, because you were someone like your past and stuff, and I think a lot many people might know your past. So if you don't mind, do you want to share how you got to be an atheist in that regard for the audience? If that's okay, I mean, you don't have to.
Yeah, no, sure. It's not a secret. I've never sort of gone into it in detail, and part of the reason I haven't gone into it in detail is it happened when I was a fairly young man. Mm-hmm. And when you sort of lose your faith as a young man, and you're not much of a critical thinker yet, and particularly reflective, your ideas tend to be confused, and then when you try to cast your mind back and remember what it was, you have a tendency to reconstruct and tell a story, tell a narrative that is perhaps a little bit more biased, edifying and biased than actually how it was. And so when I have, in my more honest moments, when I try to sort of be unflinching and tell the unvarnished truth about what it was like, it's not a particularly edifying tale of moving from superstition and dogmatism into skepticism and rationality or anything like that. It's nothing like that. So when I grew up in a household where the faith that we practiced was the faith of the Jehovah's Witnesses. We were not Jehovah's Witnesses officially. My mother was very taken up with the faith of the Jehovah's Witnesses, but could never quite go so far as to get baptized. She could never quite take that final step. But all of my youth, I grew up with reading the New World Translations of the Bible, which the New World Translation is the Jehovah's Witness translation of it into English. Okay. It's a form of biblical literalism and fundamentalism. All the Jehovah's Witness literature, you know, the Watchtower Society literature, the Awake, you know, publications, all of those publications that they sort of shove into your hand when they knock on your door, or if you're walking by on a street corner and they're
that's if you open the door.
That's if you open the door and let them in. I grew up with all that literature. The first book I can remember reading, and I remember it quite fondly actually, the first actual book, like a book with a hardcover, you know, as opposed to like a comic book that I can remember reading, was a little book of stories of Jesus called Listening to the Great Teacher. And it was all just, you know, quaint, charming little stories about Jesus, and you know, it sort of characterized him as a wise, avuncular figure that you could trust, and who was just filled with wisdom and life lessons. So I read that, and another book I read early on was the most widely published anti-evolutionary tract ever at the time, called "Did Man Get Here by Evolution or by Creation?" And I practically memorized that book, having read it many times. Well, I was a strident anti-evolutionist, a creationist. And I can remember when at the age of about 15 arguing with my biology teacher in high school and asking, to my shame now, if evolution is true, why are there still monkeys?
Oh, Pearl Box won't like you at all.
Yeah, it was dreadful. So why did I fall out of my faith? Well, a mix of good reasons and bad reasons. The good reasons had to do with the fact that I had a sort of a, quite by nature, a love of the natural world. I was into amateur astronomy and stargazing. I was into, you know, dinosaurs and all that kind of stuff growing up. And so my parents, they indulged this curiosity I had about the natural world. They bought me books about dinosaurs. They bought me books about astronomy. They bought me a telescope, and you know, Christmas, you know, it, you know, we actually, because we weren't Jehovah's Witnesses, we sometimes celebrated Christmas some years. So for instance, you know, one Christmas I remember, I got a taste of Christmas. I wasn't totally denied Christmas, even though we were most of the Jehovah's Witness. I remember I got a chemistry set, and I got a microscope, and you know, so there were all these things, geology kits, all of this stuff, and I grew up in the country, and so I was very, very much a sort of a child of nature, and I was interested in the natural world. I spent a lot of time stargazing. Now, when you read an awful lot about dinosaurs, and you read an awful lot about astronomy as a kid, you can't help reading that the Earth is very old, and the universe is very old, much older than what my theology dictated. And so I just, you know, there was this conflict, there was this terrible cognitive dissonance, because I had this enormous admiration for science and scientific discovery. And I knew enough about scientific methodology from just poring over these books and reading about all this stuff and the history of you end up training. Exactly. When you carry out an experiment with yourself, you know, you actually learn something about scientific methodology firsthand. But also, you learn an awful lot about the history of science, reading about science, right? And so you learn about the methods and the experiments and the studies that were done and the evidence that has been gathered in favor of these various theories. And it just kept bumping up against my theology, and I knew that something had to give, but I was able to bracket it for a long time and just say, no, I'm just going to compartmentalize this and just ignore it. I was taught that, no, it's just part of a conspiracy, basically. This is the devil's work. You know, he's deluding people, and, you know.
Like NASA. I saw that the other day. NASA is like a conspiracy theory, and we painted Pluto. I was just like, what? Are you shitting me? I did get that sentiment, so.
Yeah, so there was that kind of thing that was a rational factor that caused me to reconsider my faith. And then there were, bought some bananas today, and we've got a cloud of fruit flies all of a sudden here. I'm drinking a beer, and I love
them. I was going to say, it's the beer, it's not the bananas, it's the beer.
No, but they came in with the bananas, but now I'm drinking a beer, and now they're just swarming me because I'm drinking a beer. But then there were other things, you know, I couldn't make sense of Jesus having to be sacrificed, the massacre of a man. The concept of original sin didn't make sense. It didn't seem to be a loving and just God that was going to destroy the world in this sacred genocide. And I mean, I've been taught that I should pray for the second coming of Jesus, for this, you know, this massacre that was going to happen. And I was told that if I was a good Christian and not worldly, that I would literally walk through this Armageddon, that this was going to happen, all this destruction was going to happen, buildings would collapse on people, people would catch on fire, worms would eat them alive and stuff like that. I would watch all of this horror, but I would pass through it unscathed and just, you know, walk right to Jesus, you know. And we were supposed to pray for this, and this was a terrifying thing. Jehovah's Witnesses don't believe in hell. They believe in a doctrine of oblivion, when annihilationism, when you're dead, you're dead, boom. You just don't go to heaven, that's all.
That sounds a little bit closer to logic than most, to be honest, because I believe that too. But it does make me Jehovah's Witness, obviously.
No. But so I didn't fear hell, but I did fear damnation, right? I didn't want to not get into heaven, right? But it was very hard to bring myself to pray for this sacred genocide. And so that was troubling to me. And then there was the fact that prayers didn't all seem to work the way you know faith can move bounds. And it seemed to me I had all the faith that one could have. So there was just one thing after another. There were moral problems. I couldn't understand some of the moral prescriptions. And at some point I moved away from my family. I went off to college, and I was really starting to doubt my faith there. And then I started reading some philosophy, and the first philosophers I read were the existentialists, as it turns out. You know, people like Jean-Paul Sartre and a lot of existential literature, like some Tolstoy, people like Kierkegaard, Gide, Camus, those sorts of things.
Write these books down, just saying.
Yeah, it's great literature, actually. Existential literature is terrific. I mean, I'm not an existentialist, and I'm not very sympathetic to existentialism now, but it was mind-expanding at the time. And of course, it felt very liberating. And because I wasn't living in the bosom of my family anymore, I didn't have to justify my doubts and my concerns and the growing outlook that I was acquiring to anybody.
So you kind of felt a bit set free then, I guess.
Yeah, and I literally felt liberated, and it happened in a context where I wasn't having to justify myself and defend myself and having people trying to pickle, a belief back into me that I was losing. So it was fairly effortless. It was not very painful for me. I did feel like a fool. I did go through a kind of slightly angry atheist phase. I can remember at the age of about 17, or just when I turned on 18, thinking to myself, that's it, I'm an atheist. And it wasn't for the best reasons. Like, it was like, I didn't have like good reasons for thinking there was no God or no creator.
Sure,
it was, it was like, I'm a monotheist, there's only one God. And it's this God, and if it's not this God, then there's no God, you know. I bypassed all the other religions. I didn't consider other gods. I certainly didn't consider something like deism, which I think would be a much more rational position to hold. So because I came from a fundamentalist faith, my faith was very brittle. And when I couldn't sustain it, it all just sort of fell apart of a piece. And it happened very, very quickly in the span of a year. And I got lucky. It wasn't particularly painful, you know.
Do you think that is a big obstacle, though, that sentiment that you give to the whole breaking down of what you used to think and dealing with that process? Do you think that's a major issue for people who might be religious in kind but have the kind of doubts that you felt when you was like 17 or something like that?
Yeah, it's a huge thing. I mean, I was lucky. I was a young man. My character wasn't formed yet. I didn't have a strong identity wedded to this particular set of dogmas. It's harder when you're older. When you've lived a good chunk of your life this way and you have publicly self-identified this way, and everyone knows that you espouse these beliefs. You put yourself out there, right? Mm-hmm. You identify yourself with that. That to step away from that is very, very hard. First of all, it's personally embarrassing. When I mentioned there was a phase of that I felt a little angry, I felt a little angry because I felt humiliated. How could I believe these stupidities? How could I have believed these things, right? How could I have been so gullible to have accepted this for so long? And the other thing that happens that's very hard for a lot of atheists, and it produces the angry atheist syndrome in a lot of people who become atheists when they first become atheists.
It's easy to spot that, though, you know. I had commented on two people who didn't like that. I actually pointed that out. You can be, no, I don't say angry, but you've got a certain mentality, and you can just flip it over. But you'll still carry that on to being an atheist if you're not careful. You can sound just as bad as a theist if you're not careful.
Yeah, you can become very, very strident and embittered. Like what happens is you feel foolish, right? You believed a pack of nonsense, and who fed you this nonsense? Well, the people you trusted the most. So you have a tendency to feel, you know, resentment towards them. How could you? It doesn't matter that you believe these things. You weren't in a position to know these things. You didn't have good reasons for these things either. How could you have so confidently asserted all of these things and pickled these things into me, when you were not in a position to be so confident? You had no right to be so confident, to make it sound like you were just stating, you know, bald facts, demonstrable facts, right? And so you feel cheated. You feel resentful, and that can lead to bitterness. And another thing that happens, though, is on the way out of your faith, there's usually a phase there where you are trying to justify these things to yourself. You're trying to make yourself believe them. You're trying to hold on. You're clinging. Because you're afraid of not believing, right? Because it seems like, well, geez, if I lose this, then what's going to happen? I might lose my whole moral perspective. What happens then? Where will my values come from? Things like that. Those are important considerations. And so you have a tendency to cling and fight for your old beliefs, your cherished dogmas. And what ends up happening is you go through a period of intellectual dishonesty with yourself, where you're merely professing to believe things, and you're looking for rationalizations to shore up what you profess to believe, but you no longer in your heart of hearts believe. And so on the way out of your falling out of your faith, almost every atheist is on their way out deceiving themselves, and they know it. And that is embarrassing when you look back on it. And I think that I have this view that I think a lot of atheists, when they are talking to a person of faith, they have a tendency to think, you are in the same position I was in. You are acting in bad faith. You know in your heart of hearts, right, that it's not true. I have a tendency to repeat this, but it's important because I think it's important because we can be very uncharitable sometimes. We can forget what it was like to be a sincere believer and only remember what it was like to be an insincere believer, because that is our last experience on the way out of faith, is being an insincere believer. And we have a tendency to project that onto the people we're talking to. Some of them are insincere believers, but a lot of people are very sincere believers. Mm-hmm. And if you forget that, then you will treat everybody like they are being intellectually dishonest all the time, and you will not be very intellectually charitable towards them, and you'll not be personally charitable towards them. Mm-hmm. And that, I think, also conduces to people being appearing very bitter and angry and intolerant and even bigoted against the religious. A failure to cast their mind back to what it was like to sincerely believe and to properly empathize.
Mm-hmm. What would be your tactic? I know that's a bad word to use, tactic, but what would be your approach to trying to guide people who are trying to come out of that state of mind? Or even how would you, this kind of a two-part question, really. Answer that first, now I'll ask you the other one afterwards. What do you think is the best way to approach this problem of people in faith and stuff?
Okay, well, the first thing I would say is I don't try to talk people out of their faith. Mm-hmm.
Understanding of an approach. When I talk to like G-Man or Pillbox or anybody of this nature, I just accept their position. I used to fight against it because I used to be an atheist, but obviously I'm not anymore. And that's kind of embarrassing for me that I used to call myself an atheist. That sounds really strange to you. But I feel the same embarrassment because I used to torture poor theists. But I just kind of accept the position because I think you can understand them more when you give them the benefit of doubt, so to speak. Not in the sense that God exists, but to try and understand where they're coming from. Do you know what I mean? So how would you approach that then? Like, in the Google Plus sphere? Because it does seem there's a
Oh,
lot of hate back and forth between the
yeah.
two.
Okay. Well, I have a lot to say about that.
Go for it.
About how, in fact, I did an entire show on the New Covenant Group a few weeks ago. It was called Questioning the Value of the Great Debate. I recommend people watch that. Go over to the New Covenant Group channel, and there's an episode there called Questioning the Value of the Great Debate. And we talked about that, and I had a lot to say there about how to have these discussions. And okay, well, first of all, in these discussions, I don't try to talk people out of their faith. And the reason is, I just is that there's no magic bullet. There's no procedure for doing that sort of thing anyway. You never know what's going to make cause a person to tumble out of their faith. Sometimes it's a good reason, and sometimes it's a purely emotional thing. And very often it's an emotional thing. It's emotional things that tend to move people to faith, and tends to be an emotional thing that moves people out of their faith. And then people then afterwards have a tendency to look for reasons that will be in service of the conclusion that they've come to. That's just sort of the way of how we work. But I mean, when I talk to people of faith, I try to understand their position. I try to listen. The most important thing for me is applying the principle of intellectual charity. There's an important philosophical and discursive principle. It's a norm of rational and civil discourse. It's called the principle of intellectual charity, and it simply says, when you are in a discussion or an argument with someone or a debate, whatever, ascribe or attribute to the other person at least as much intelligence as you have, and that they are as knowledgeable as you are. And you can scale down if it becomes apparent that they don't know as much as you do and stuff like that, so you don't end up talking over their heads, condescending and stuff like that. But you should always assume that people are intelligent, and you should always, when you're interpreting what they're saying, try to interpret it in the most rational and positive light. Don't inter like if there's two ways to interpret what they're saying, don't interpret it in the stupid way, right? Always interpret it in the most charitable way. That's the principle of intellectual charity. Credit people with intelligence and knowledge and understanding and sincerity, and try to construe what they're saying in such a way that it sounds intelligent. If someone is saying something and on its face it sounds crazy, think again. Maybe you're misunderstanding it, right? And in the and a way to test this, the way to sort of make sure you're doing this right, is in the course of arguing with a person or discussing or debating, whatever it is you're doing with a person, ask them, just say, well, okay, hang on, let me see if I got your position right. It sounds to me like you're saying this. And then try to characterize it fairly. Don't try to characterize it in a way that's going to make it sound ridiculous for rhetorical purposes. Just try to characterize it just to make sure that they go, yeah, that's right. Yeah.
So
If they come
it's
back at you.
clarifying positions really in that regard. It's giving them the opportunity to clarify if you don't understand it instead of I think that's a lot of that goes on G Plus though. The narrative that you just said where instead of saying can you clarify your position, it's just like boom, it's a troll, gotcha, and the next thing it's a bloody meme or some stuff. So I totally agree with that actually.
Yeah. And the advantages of it are, well, first of all, it de-escalates the conversation. People are much happier to talk to you when they think you are genuinely trying to understand what their position is, and you're making an effort to understand it. And if you say, well, it seems to me you're saying this, and they go, no, I'm not saying that. Oh, okay, I apologize. Okay, hang on. So say it to me again, perhaps in different words. Let's go at it. And then you go through it a couple of times, so you go, okay, seems to me you're saying this now. Is this right? And sometimes you end up practically parroting what they're saying. But the idea is to try to put it in your own words, because of course you can parrot their words and still misunderstand it. You want to try to own it and put it in your own words. And when you do that, a couple of things happen. First of all, the walls come down. People have a tendency to throw up walls and get defensive. When you do this, the walls have a tendency to come down because it feels like it's a cooperative venture now. It is a discussion. It is you are you, it's a meeting of minds, and I don't mean and by meeting of minds I don't mean an agreement. I mean you're actually meeting their mind. You're actually connecting with what they think, and that's important because you can't get as far as refuting or objecting to a position unless you know what it is. You have to be getting it right. If you don't, you're aiming all of your ammunition at the wrong thing. It's a straw man, and people straw man, to use that as a verb, they straw man each other all the time without even knowing it. Not, without even intending it, right? And then the other person says, "Ah, oh, you're straw-manning me." And of course, the other person isn't applying the principle of intellectual charity. They're assuming that the other person is doing it deliberately. And so the whole thing breaks down, and it just becomes a debacle. So I try to avoid that, and I so I try to avoid leading questions and gotcha questions. And I don't tell people, how do you define this? You know, I never demand a definition. I always say, well, what do you mean by this? Just explain it to me. I don't need a sentence that captures, you know, the necessary and sufficient conditions for the, you know, I don't need that. I just tell me what you mean. I just describe it. Give me some examples, put it in words, explain. Okay, now I get your meaning, okay? But people have a tendency to listen for the purposes of finding an angle, a chink in the armor. Mm-hmm.
We're going to get into these type of people soon, don't worry.
Okay.
It's copy on the bullshit. So you're going to have to name some, so don't be shy.
Okay, well, the reason you're bringing this up for those who don't know is I, on my channel and when I do hangouts and stuff like that, I try as hard as possible not to talk about persons and individuals because I think that the debate is actually an important debate, right? A lot, people roll their eyes when you mention the great debate. You know, they can't say the great debate with a straight face. They go, yeah. The great debate. They got to make a funny sound out of it.
We call it the great derp. Eight.
right, the great derp. Eight. People are embarrassed by it. But the great debate is not called the great debate because the quality of the debate is so
great.
It's not. The quality of the debate is typically terrible. It depends who you're talking to, right? It's called the great debate because it's because of how long the discussion has been going on. This is a consequential question that has interested people across cultures for millennia. It is great the way the Great Wall of China is great. It's huge. It's a question that transcends time and space, and it remains consequential to this day. It's that sense that the word great is being applied when people say the great debate. So I'm never embarrassed to talk about the great debate. It is the great debate. There is no question that is more consequential to people than whether or not there's a God, especially for people who think that there is a God. It's less consequential for people who think there is no God, typically. But nevertheless, it's still a consequential question. It informs our politics. It informs morality.
That's the thing I was going to say. That's a consequence of existence itself. It's not so much the narrative of a God, but the God aspect is there because a lot of people have chosen that's the narrative of what existence may be in the sense of how we got here. I like to think myself personally that the question is fundamentally flawed to begin with. It from a physics position, in order for you to ask questions requires input from your environment. So I could never ask how the birds fly if there was no such thing as birds, right? So everything we've got in our environment is kind of a reflection of why we ask questions. And questions themselves are only clarifications of what we already know. In some regards, it's just we would like to clarify it, right? So when dealing with the great debate, is I find it amusing sometimes and also very informative. I've learned a lot of stuff myself personally from the so-called great debate, from the likes of yourself and other people who are on the ball, that the question itself is a bit wacky, you know, God.
Yeah, I understand. I understand that sentiment. I don't agree with it though. Like a lot of people, you're a self-styled igtheist or theological non-cognitivist. That's someone who thinks that the whole question is so muddled and so confused, and people are talking past each other, and they think they're communicating, but everyone seems to have a different definition of God, and there's no there. There's nothing objective to point to ground what they're talking about. So that really, it's just a muddle. It's just like people talking about colorless green ideas that sleep furiously. What the hell are you talking about? You know, those are words.
I like the way you threw that quote. It was very nice.
Well, it's a famous line. It's a famous line from linguistics that by Chomsky.
One of my favorite philosophers actually, and he destroys solipsism by actually explaining linguistics. In my own opinion.
Well, I'm not familiar with where he does that or how he does it, but
I will link you the video after this show. It's really cool.
Okay. But in any case, I think that that a lot of God talk makes sense. And so what you were saying, for instance, is, you know, when you gave the example of we wouldn't ask about, you know, birds and what a bird is unless there was something in our experience that motivated the question in the first place. But what the hell is there that motivates the question of God in the first place? But I think there are things that motivate the God question. First of all, when you look at the natural world, there are things in the natural world that look purposive, that look like they were design. They look like they have functions. You know, hands are for grasping, eyes are for seeing, the heart is for pumping.
Bananas.
So just on prima facie, at first blush, right, Things look teleological. They look like they exist for purposes and functions. They serve interests. And so that, I think, brings to mind, well, okay, but then that means that something must have purposed them. And so I think that properly motivates the question. I think that's fine. The fact that things are a certain way, and that they are beautiful, that they are wondrous, that they are complicated, that so much gets accomplished with so little. You know, we've got finite types of particles, but arranged in different ways produce everything that we find around us. I mean, that's kind of wondrous. I mean, this is quite the Lego set we live in, you know?
Yeah, I think there's like seven basic elements or something that creates the entire universe.
But there's no arranged
in a billion different ways. I think it's seven. I'm not so sure. I need to catch up on probably me chemistry there. But I think it's like seven.
Yeah, I have no idea what the ultimate bestiary is. I thought it was much many more particles than that. But whatever it is, it doesn't matter. The point is, it's a manageable number of things that are interacting in complex ways in fields of force, and it produces all of this enormous variety of phenomena that we find, and it produces things like us. And it produces things that are conscious and can be aware of it in the first place. All of this, I think, beggars the question, why is it the way it is? How did it come to be?
Yeah.
And some of it implies, suggests anyway, that maybe there was an intelligence behind it. So I don't think the question is ill-motivated. And so we can imagine ourselves being, you know, artifact makers, creators. I don't think that there's anything bizarre about positing an intelligence far, far faster than our own that could have brought this about, but through means as yet undeterminable.
I would agree with you before on your sentiment about theism. I would say if God, in whatever shape or form, does exist, it would be logically a deist. It wouldn't even know we exist, but we just like we didn't know atoms existed in that regards, but they do. But they make us work as sentient beings, right? Because these are little inanimate objects, trillions of them, that make up your body. Now, we can't see them, but they're there. We never touch anything, but we've got the sensation of touch. So that's a bit weird. So if you could apply that weirdness to, let's say, the creation of the universe, yes, a deity would be more preferable for my logical instincts than a god that is engaging in said universe, where he's dictating the rules of the game specifically to us. That doesn't make no sense. That's just wacky. But then again, I could be wrong as well. I don't know, because I've got no burden of proof on either or, I guess.
I can easily imagine a god that is like a creator god now, like a deistic god that created everything, set it into motion, and is not particularly concerned in us. You know, maybe this is like a petri dish. Maybe he's got one of 50 petri dishes, and this universe is just one of many. And he's just sort of running an experiment, and he just wants to see what happens when the particles are set up with, you know, and doing certain things. You know, he sets the laws of physics in motion, and let's see where it goes. And he's not particularly concerned with any outcome. Or you
might
can imagine
even
that
know.
This. He might not know, or he might know, and he might have an interest in a certain outcome, and we might be that outcome, or something else might be the outcome. Might not be us. You know, we might be, you know, I mean, you know, unicellular organism.
A means to an end, you know, so to speak.
From the standpoint of teleology of a creator god that wanted to create us, you know, unicellular organisms would have been a step along the way to creating us. But for all we know, we are a step on the way to something else, right? From the if one posits that kind of god. So, I mean, a creator god could be indifferent, or he could be terribly invested in us, or he might be invested in us to the extent that it matters for some other ultimate purpose. Who the hell knows? So all of these, to me, are live possibilities. They're not plausibilities. I don't think they're plausible, but they're logically possible. They're not incoherent. I just don't think there's any reason to believe them. I have, in recent months, sort of been thinking this through. I used to take a harder, more atheistic line on this. I now, I would say, with respect to certain deistic conceptions of God, I would say that I'm agnostic with respect to some of those. But for instance, with the Abrahamic gods, Yahweh and Allah, you know, those gods I think are falsified. I'm a strong atheist with respect to those. I think that those obviously don't exist. Those to me are as fictional as Zeus. I think they're preposterous, and I struggle to understand why people still believe them. I do in fact understand the reasons, but it, it you know it,
Like you, when you was coming from religion, though, isn't it? That thing, like when you was coming out of religion, it's just like, wow, I feel stupid. Not because what you felt at the time was stupid, it's like you've learned more and you're like, ooh, the universe is a lot more complex than just the simplified notion of this. But the purpose behind it as well, like you said, you know, you learned about the universe and all that stuff, and this is an approach that doesn't agree with that. Not because you don't want it to, it's just it doesn't gel. And humans are really good at gelling shit together, in my opinion, given enough time and enough, you know, space, like Rubik's Cubes. You know, the universe is a big Rubik's Cube, and we need time to solve that bugger.
The grandeur of the universe, I think, doesn't really pose a problem to the Abrahamic faiths, because the grandeur the universe is, the grandeur the God has to be that they posit, right? So they're happy with that, you know. The more magnificent and spectacular and awe-inspiring the universe is, as discovered by astronomy and physics and all that, the happier they are, because it just makes their God grander. So for me, the problem is that the God of the Abrahamic faiths is so very obviously a projection of human interests. It's so obvious. Like God is a king, you know, he sits on some kind of throne. Not, he doesn't sit physically on a throne, it's all figurative, but why does he have to occupy a throne? Why does he have to be a king? You know, this is so very obviously the talk of people who grew up in a world where power and authority issued from kings, and so they projected that onto their God, right? Mm-hmm. This is a God that has human-like emotions. You know, he gets petty and
spite,
and he's vengeful and he's wrathful and he gets angry, but he can also be moved to compassion. And I mean, this is so obviously an anthropomorphization, a personification
of a human,
of the concept of a creator. Yeah, this is just a bigger, more badass Zeus.
Yeah,
right? Just a bit larger, right? I find that those conceptions of God are kind of debasing. You know, mm-hmm. We have outgrown these conceptions of gods. If you're going to believe in a God, for goodness sakes, have it be a concept of a God that's born of looking at the world and not looking at the literature of the first century. It should be born of looking at physics and cosmology and biology and logic and philosophy, and it should be born of looking at the world and everything that the world has delivered to us, and not be constrained or beholden by an old model. Yeah. I mean, we could discover that a God exists. It's not inconceivable. Right? Heck, Yahweh could prove that he exists if he wanted to. I mean, he could show up. He could show up 1,000 feet tall, and he could say out in a booming voice,
like
"I
aliens.
Am that I am." And yeah, he could move the stars around so that they all spell out, you know, "I am the God of Abraham." And so, and astronomers could confirm that the stars have actually moved, and they spell out, "I am the God of Abraham." And
everybody
every
would shit themselves. That would be awesome.
Yeah. and he could stamp "Made by Yahweh" on every particle. You know,
yeah.
he could deliver a private, incommunicable or communicable religious message to everybody in the world who was awake, so that you would turn to the person next to you and say, "Oh my goodness, you won't believe what just happened to me." And then the other person would say, "Hey, I just had this experience." And everyone would relate the same experience. Everyone who's asleep would wake up and say, "I just had a dream in which this was revealed to me." I mean, if that happened, if Yahweh did that, or Allah did that, you know, if Yahweh did that, you know, then Yahweh would stand revealed as a fact. And, you know, yeah. Christianity would be revealed as a science.
Well, that's the thing. I go down that route. I try and do it. I try and use that same argument when talking about gravity without bias. Because a fact is without bias in the sense of when looking at things objectively, right? So it has to apply regardless of how you think. You have to take thinking out of the equation when it comes to objectivity, like gravity. Now, did gravity exist before we did? Yes, it did. Like, we only know because you can reverse time and stuff because of mathematics and stuff. But in regards to, is God real in one particular fashion, which is Yahweh, then if we all had the same experience, like everybody, then we could classify that as a fact, because it would be without bias, because everybody just experienced it, just like everybody experiences gravity.
Yeah, we would experience intersubjective agreement, right? We could all, like, I can, you know, hold up this beer glass, and, you know, without saying what it is, I could say, "Hey, Stai, you know, what do you see here?" And you could describe what you see, and I would say,
"Loveliness,
yep, that's right. That comports with my experience." And I could say, "Joe, what do you see?" And then Joe could relate what he sees without having heard what either of us have said. And then we could all say, "Yep, okay, there we go. We have intersubjective agreement." You know, and it's hard to achieve that. When it comes to God talk, but it's possible in principle. I mean, I just described a scenario where God could do all these things, and poof, you know, there it is. There we would have our intersubjective agreement. So if a God really existed and wanted to be worshipped and wanted to be known, and he was all powerful, how could he fail to be known? I mean, if I want to be known to the, like, if there's a guy walking down the street and I want to make sure that he knows I exist, I have nothing more difficult to do than get out of my chair, out the door, and go, "Hi, I'm Ozzy," you know? I mean, how could a God that is all-powerful and allegedly wants to be known by his creation,
how could he fail?
You know,
well, isn't that where the whole test of faith comes into play, then? Isn't that one of the tactics you... isn't that one of the positions used to say, well, God wants you to do it voluntarily? He doesn't want you... It's like you saying hi to somebody, but standing there and letting them just walk past you and not saying hi. Because you've got the choice to say hi, so to speak.
Yeah, when people say, "Well, listen, what God wants you to do is believe on faith," what they're saying is God wants you to believe despite not having a reason to believe, right? I mean, that, well, too bad. I mean, that's, you know, so much the worse for God for asking for something stupid.
Right? Yeah.
If God is going to require that I abandon sound epistemological principles so that I can believe in him,
that's fine.
But yeah, and then they could say, "Oh, yeah, but God, that's his prerogative." Okay, well, that's his prerogative. But what you're saying is it's his prerogative to be an asshole, right? I mean, now you're positing a God not worthy of worship, right? Now, most theists wouldn't do that. Most theists would say, no, God has given you sufficient reason. Look at the world. There's evidence in the world that it is a creation. Consider the fact that you have a conscience. Consider the fact that you have a mind. And they would point to certain things, features of reality, that they think indicate, point in the direction that there is a God, and that are best explained by positing a God. And so they would say, you know, there is in fact evidence sufficient for you to entertain the possibility of a God. And then if you open your mind and your heart to it, then, you know, according to Christianity anyway, the Holy Spirit can sort of indwell you, and then and then can and consequently evidence that was unavailable before will suddenly be made available to you. You know, this is belief on the installment plan. Believe now, get the evidence later, right? I don't subscribe to the belief on the installment plan. If you want me to believe something, you got to try and give me a reason to believe wherever possible. You know, there are some things that we do have to take on faith. But just because there are some things that we have to take on faith doesn't mean that that's a license to believe any old thing on faith. Mm-hmm. And I'm certainly not going to organize my life around a set of dogmas and ancient books simply because a person assures me that there exists a being that has mandated that I believe on the installment plan. Believe now, get the evidence later.
Yeah, but isn't it contradictory, though, when you think about the whole free will, just part of the Abrahamic thing, in the sense where if God gave me the ability to choose and I choose no, well, why would he bear me then? He's only given me the ability to choose. So I don't understand. I've never understood that part of it. We're like, okay, I've got free will. Not that I believe that, because I'm a determinist. But, in fact, I'm a compatibilist in some regards, just because of quantum mechanics, but that's a bit deeper. But let's just say I've got free will, and there's this thing that someone says, this thing exists, and he gives you this ability. But you've got the right to choose, because he loves you. So you've got the right to choose. And I'm just like, well...
Does he love you?
Yeah, I'm thinking, well... How can you bear me if you just give me the right to choose? If you like Elsie just said, if you're the supreme being, what is stopping you? It sounds like self-gratification more than anything else. Like, pray to me. Catch-22, motherfucker.
The Christian will tell you it's for his glory. That's usually the rhetoric. So
it sounds like a stuck-up cunt to me.
Well, yeah, I mean, the idea that a being that exists necessarily, that depends on nothing for its existence, that contains every perfection, that wants and needs for nothing, that this thing would require obeisance and obedience and adulation and worship and glorification. That just seems to me bizarre. I mean, I understand why people want those things. I understand why
bizarre.
A tyrant or a king,
people
right?
Are bizarre.
People crave power, and they crave security, and they crave resources. And so I understand why people who are in positions of power want to extract from people signs of obedience, and signs of deference, and adulation, and pledges of loyalty, and all that. I understand why a human would want that. I understand why a finite being that is at risk of losing power has a proper motivation for trying to secure that kind of adulation. Yeah. Why a being that needs nothing, that will always exist and always has existed, at some point suddenly decides that it needs to, that or wants to create a world where there will be beings that will do all this, that is bizarre. This is, again, modeled on kingship. These are ancient tyrants mapped, projected onto a creator. Mm-hmm. This is a petty god. These gods offend me. They offend my sensibilities.
They offend my intellect. It's true. Because how can you project that? How can you even apply a want to a god that is all-knowing and all-be?
God wants for nothing, needs nothing, wants nothing.
So how can
has always existed and always will. What does a god have thoughts for?
I've said that before. You know what? You just made a perfect point. God wouldn't even need to do anything. That's why I find it really hard when applying any logical posit to a god. And that's why I chose atheism over, not because I don't accept people's positions that this isn't a possibility. It's the fact that the universe itself doesn't allow for that, because how does one mix something that is not logical, because there's no parameters there, with logic that has parameters? I don't know how you do that. I've tried to figure it out in the sense of reading lots of books and stuff, but I still haven't found anyone who can show me how you can apply a human's understanding of the universe and logic, the way the universe is structured, and then saying they somehow apply to something that exists forever, always has, doesn't do anything other than just be there. Like, where am I supposed to put my parameters or start my parameters? I don't know how I'm supposed to do that.
The difficulty I have with positing these gods as explanations, because this is what the people will do. They'll say, well, how do you explain why there's life? How do you explain why there's anything? You know, how do you explain the beauty, order, harmony, and complexity, and patternicity that we find, and regularities that we see in the universe and stuff like that? They think that they've sort of got an explanation. Now, in fact, that it's a placeholder for an explanation. They in fact, have no mechanisms. God just does stuff. That, you know, wills things.
Exactly.
Who knows how? So it's not actually an explanation. But all of this talk positing this grand omnipotent being, all it does is engender more mystery, because, like, well, why does this god create a universe or want to create a universe? Oh, because he wants, it's for his own glorification. Why does God want glory, right? What is this self-existing being that has always existed and always shall exist and wants and needs for nothing?
He's showing off.
Why would it want and require? Of sentient beings that they glorify it. Oh, because he deserves it. Well, why does he care about what he deserves? He needs nothing. I mean, I know when I deserve something, or when something is denied me that I do deserve, we understand in the human cases why we have these concepts.
Exactly.
Right? It's to satisfy our needs and interests. But a god has no needs. Right, so why does a god have any wants? Why does a god think? I know why I think. This meat machine in my head that allows me to think and navigate through the world and form a map of reality that changes and co-varies systematically with changes around me, so that my map is constantly being updated and constantly reflecting what's going on around me. What we call our beliefs. That's what your belief set is. Your belief set is your map of reality. I understand why I have beliefs. I understand why I have thoughts and ideas. they're what keep an animal going. I mean, if your beliefs are inveterately wrong, you're going to be chewing when there's no food in your mouth. You're going to be fleeing when there's nothing there. Exactly. You're not going to have any behavior that's appropriate to your circumstances unless your map of reality is approximately right with respect to reality. Mm-hmm. So that's why we have thoughts. Why does a God that has no needs and is self-existing, why does it have to have thoughts? Right? So all of these questions arise. More questions arise by positing a God than could ever be answered. And in fact, there is no question that is, in fact, demonstrably answered by a God. A lot of people will say, well, God would answer this if he existed. Yeah, but what's the mechanism? Again, we don't know. So it's never really an intellectually satisfying answer. I mean, you have to set the bar very low on what you think an answer is. If you think God exercised his omnipotent will and brought it into existence,
that's the thing I'm just totally going to agree with you on before when you said that we project what a God is instead of trying to figure out the underlying problem of we don't know, right? If people had a bit more humility and said, look, we don't know what the hell is going on here, but we know we exist, you know, hence science. And we can also use philosophy to further science as well, because we can ask questions of the universe. But once you start positing this arbitrary thing called a God, then it does become a bit grey for me or for people like your good self, you know? So it gets a bit weird in that regards.
Yeah, and there's also an element of you have to use your own reasoning to come to these conclusions. So we're kind of all in the same position of having to, you know, draw conclusions based on what we experience and how we interpret our experiences. So I think you have to also warn that with when you're talking to believers, you have to remember, but they're not really willing to admit that because I guess it'd be a tricky thing to have to argue. But
it's hard. Wonder,
yeah, it is. It is. It's hard to do because we're all using the same kind of processes to draw conclusions from things. And I've always wondered what special knowledge you have that I don't. I would love to possess it.
Yeah, give it to me. I want some as well.
Well, I mean, a lot of people would say that they don't have special knowledge, that the evidence is there to be found. You're just not interpreting the facts properly. That if you were a little more reasonable, you would interpret the facts differently, and you would come to a different conclusion. You would come to the right conclusion. Whereas others would say, well, you're right. You don't have all of the facts. You know, God has to reveal himself to you. So, I mean, theology will dictate whether or not the evidence there is sufficient already, or whether there's a missing ingredient. And you know, I mean, then there are people who are fideists. A fideist is where we get the word fidelity, and it's the Latin word for faith, fides. A fideist is someone who thinks, no, there is no sufficient evidence, period. There is no such thing as a rationally warranted belief in a God or Jesus or Christianity. It is in fact a faith position. You just have to have faith. And these people are unembarrassed and unashamed of this. They admit, nope, there's just faith. Yeah, this is a faith commitment, cliff. Right? And now that I don't think is a very rational position, but at least they are not pretending that the facts are there to be seen and everyone else is just misunderstanding it who doesn't agree with them. Mm-hmm. They at least are crediting, well, those people who don't believe have good reason not to believe.
That's more so an acceptance position, right, in that regards. It's like, I just accept it's faith. Fuck off. You know?
Yeah, yeah. And ultimately, well, I don't think anybody should be intellectually satisfied with that position.
To be honest with you, I think I would agree with that more only because it is intellectually honest in the sense that they are not prescribing truth claims. They're just saying, look, I just believe in it, so I can't explain it. I can't give you a fact or anything, but I just, in my heart, feel this is the case. I give people like that more credence than I would with somebody who says, no, it's a fact. I'd be like,
I'll quibble with you here. It is a truth claim, but a truth claim is merely when you claim that something is the case, right? Mm-hmm. So if you believe something, you believe that it's the case, right?
Yeah, but it's the case to them, though, isn't it? It's the case to them. They're not trying to externalize it. So it is the truth to them. They're not trying to posit truth claim in regards to your claims. They're saying it's true to them.
They're not necessarily claiming that it's a knowledge claim, that they're in a position of knowing it. They'll say that I believe it, And if they believe it, they think it's true, and presumably they think that you should believe it too. That is, you'd be wise to believe it, but unfortunately you don't. So, and there, fideists come into two camps, broadly speaking. There are fideists who think faith is the only way to get there, and since I don't have a rational way of persuading you, you're blameless if you don't have faith. God may condemn you, but I will not. Right? But then there are fideists who say, no. You have to believe. Because God, if God condemns you, then I have to condemn you too. You should believe. Yes, it's true. I don't have a reason that would persuade you. I don't have a reason that persuades me. Nevertheless, I listen to my heart, and I have this, this feeling that moves me in that direction, and I'm obeying that feeling. I have a cause, not a justification, not a rational justification. And you have that feeling in you too. You're just ignoring it, right? And you had better get on board with it. So not all fideists are cute and cuddly. This is just my faith. I'm not demanding that you have it, right? In fact, I think that those fideists who say that, look, I'm just saying it's what I believe. But I don't think that it's important that you believe, right? Or I'm not requiring that you believe. I don't require that anyone believe anything I believe anyway, yeah. Even when I do have evidence, right?
Do you think there's a slight guilt trip there, but like a little sly one? Do you think there's a little slight guilt trip there and saying like,
No, I think it's more. Please don't beat me up. I'm not pushing my beliefs on you. Please don't press me for reasons. I think that's what it is. I really think it is almost always a position
just
of intellectual cowardice.
Leave me alone. I'm scared. God's going to fuck me up.
It's not so much that as I think that they recognize that they don't have
a leg to stand on.
A leg to stand on, and they don't want to be pressed on it, and they're tired of being hectored by people who think, well, look, if you don't have a leg to stand on, why are you trying to stand on it,
yeah.
Right? Stop pretending that you're levitating, you know. And I think that move of, look, I'm not saying that you have to believe it. This is just what I believe. Look, if you believe it, then you think it's true.
Mm.
If you think it's true, don't you think that I should believe what's true? Right, you're not necessarily. Nobody's in a position to mandate that another person believe anything.
So it's a defense. It's a defense mechanism, like you said, then to not get
Yeah, it's just a way of saying, please don't hurt me. Please don't attack me. Okay, I'm trying not to be pushy. So please preemptively don't. It's a preemptive move. Please don't attack my position because I'm not going to try and defend it. My feeling is, look. I ask people to justify whatever it is that they believe, just as I am prepared to try and justify whatever it is I can believe. And I have faith positions, too. I'm not going to pretend that I don't, right? I think we all do, in fact. I think at the bottom of all rationality are irreducible faith claims that cannot even be justified except on pain of circular reasoning, what are sometimes called properly basic beliefs. And these are at the very ground, the very foundation of reasonable and rationality and
it's trust, isn't it? It's trust in them.
Yeah, that's right. But it's an unwarranted trust because there's no way to warrant them or vindicate them even after the fact because you'd have to use them in the process of the vindication. So you'd be assuming that their reliability and truthfulness in the very act of trying to justify their truthfulness mm-hmm. and reliability. So, but anyway, I don't want to get into that. But my point is that I'm not someone who's allergic to the word faith. I'm not scared of saying there are things that I take on faith. Mm-hmm. But I'm not someone who thinks that just because there are some things that we do take on faith, and have to take on faith unavoidably. That's a license to believe any old goddamn thing mm-hmm. on insufficient evidence. That's not a license to believe any old damn thing. Mm-hmm. And so I will openly say that there are certain things, induction. That for me is a faith claim. I believe induction. I don't have a way of justifying induction without arguing in a circle. There isn't an inductive argument because that would be circular, and there isn't a deductive argument for it, and there's no abductive argument. There is no justifying. The principle of induction, and there are other things that I could list. I have a whole video on my channel about properly basic beliefs where I get into that. But, that's not a license to believe any old damn thing. So the fact that there are some things that are fundamental, there's a special subset of our beliefs that we all share in common, that we all have to take on faith, and out of those, everything else is made possible. The fact that there's a special subset of beliefs that we have to take on faith doesn't mean that we can at any point jettison reason and abandon warrant and justification. Yes, and I don't care if a person wants to say, leave me alone, I'm soft and cuddly, please don't demand justification.
Wouldn't you say that was a commonality of this role of Noam Chomsky doing this linguistics thing? Wouldn't you agree that's a commonality of the uses of language? In that regards, or the misuse of language in some regards, where some people say faith and literally mean it in regards to a creator, where you clearly stated, no, I can have faith that the shop's going to be open when I go there. Now, it might be closed, right? But I've got faith that it's open. But that's not the same faith claim as God exists.
Well, there's a shell game with faith. There's a shell game that gets played with faith, right? We use the word faith in many ways, okay? There's faith in the sense of blind faith, and then there's faith in the sense of warranted trust, right? But I've been talking about blind faith. I think that there are certain things that we all take on blind faith, just like the religious believe a lot of things on blind faith. I'm not allergic to the word faith, and I don't think that atheists and non-believers and non-theists in general, whether they are agnostics or atheists or atheists or whatever, all of those non-theists, all of those people who've never heard of a God and consequently don't believe in a God, right? People who lack a belief for whatever reason. Mm-hmm. I don't think that any of those people need to be afraid of the word belief and afraid of the word faith. A lot of people, you'll hear a lot of people saying things like, I don't believe evolution, I accept evolution. And when I hear that, I want to slap my head, because for goodness sakes, to say that you accept evolution is to say that you believe evolution.
Quibble.
Well, no, it's not a quibble. A belief is accepting something as true. To believe something is to accept it as true. Belief doesn't mean blind faith.
I'm just gonna fucking throw a dictionary at you now. Only because I not to use dictionaries, but in the case of how I perceive the word belief, I do agree. There's different types of belief. Totally, I totally agree with that. But when accepting a position, in my opinion, there's nothing wrong with saying forcefully that I accept something, instead of saying I take it on merit of I don't know, in that regard of, like you say, faith and using that word. I've had that discussion with JD Kane before, and we both went over the word believe. If I believe in God, that's not the same as I believe the shop's going to be open, because it requires context, which is based on linguistics and has nothing to do with the psychology of it in the sense of philosophy. So
I think both words are being used the same there. I mean, they're both being used to describe what's called a propositional attitude, okay? Consider a proposition like the cat is on the mat, okay? Mm-hmm. There are different attitudes I can have towards that proposition. I can fear that the cat is on the mat. So the proposition is the cat is on the mat. The attitude is the fear. I can fear the cat is on the mat. I can hope the cat is on the mat. I can desire that the cat is on the mat. I can dread that the cat is on the mat. I can promise that the cat will be on the mat. I can, all these attitudes. But one of the attitudes I can have with respect to the cat being on the mat is I can believe that the cat is on the mat. Now, all it means to believe a proposition, to believe P, is to think that P is true. To say the cat is on the mat, just saying that proposition, to assert that proposition, is merely to say, I believe the cat is on the mat. So there's a lot of ways to express a belief. I can say, this is a beer glass. I believe this is a beer glass. It is my considered opinion that this is a beer glass, and so on, right? Those are all ways of expressing a belief. You don't have to stick the words, I believe, in front of a proposition to express a belief. If I can say, hey, that chick is beautiful, what am I doing? I'm expressing a belief that that chick is beautiful, right? So that is a belief. Nobody, is merely asserting or accepting a proposition is true.
No, but that's what I'm saying, though, but it would be easier to not even use the word believe, because it's used by theists, in my opinion.
But that's giving them the word.
But that's my point exactly, Ozzy. I don't want to give them the word in regards to how they use it.
You just did right there.
I'm trying to explain.
I've never heard that prior to this today.
No, hold on, dude. I'm trying to explain to you that in the dictionary, right? I'm sorry to use dictionary, fucking shit. It says, especially without evidence, right?
And yeah, but that's a kind of belief. That's an unwarranted belief. We have a word for that. That's an unwarranted or an unjustified belief, right?
Yes, but
we have other kinds of beliefs, right? The belief that this is a beer glass is a well-warranted, well-justified, well-supported, well-corroborated.
Yes, but you can't apply that to God.
No,
you can't apply the same contextual sentence to God. It's right there.
You have to have the argument with the theist about whether or not you can do it, right, with respect to God. Because, of course, a theist does think that you can do it with God.
Yeah, well, that's
a
theist,
a theist who isn't a fideist is going to think, yes, you can do it for God. There are reasons, you know. So, but the point is that the word believe is not a word that we need to be allergic to, right? But see, what happens is people they hear the word faith used in connection with religion. They hear the word belief used in connection with religion. The next thing you know, they want to say, "I don't have faith and I don't have beliefs."
Well,
we
have this
discussion. We sound stupid when we say we don't have beliefs. Of course, everyone has beliefs, right?
We had this discussion with Sam Harrison. His book title, it does quit. It's pretty interesting little thing about spirituality, right? You could use that same word, spirituality. How do we define what that is? Now, from my point of view, no, it was only that I went and asked about this book. I think someone got a bit confused. I went and bothered about this book because Sam Harris is an atheist, so I'm not going to pressure him that much. But in that regards to the title of his book, which is A Guide to Spirituality, I think, without God or something like that. I think you know better because you actually posted the link. I thought it was really interesting.
Yeah, I forgot. Yeah, something.
But it's all on the mind.
But
I just thought the title was ironic because I was like, wow, that just reminds me of like the people who sell like UFO and crystal books and shit like that, because the New Age people are into that. And that's actually it came from like the 70s or something, where spirituality, it was the New Age zeitgeist of the time. And it's actually coming back a little bit, where it's okay not to be religious, but you could be spiritual. I'm like, well, I'm not too sure about that word. Not that I don't understand how people use it.
I share your misgivings about the word spiritual. I mean, a lot of people who just believe in a lot of woo, but don't, you know, this is just common. Like, people who believe in New Age twaddle will invariably describe themselves as spiritual but not religious, which is to say that they don't like organized religions, but they are still the same kind of superstitious, religiously minded people. They just don't belong to an organized religion with an established creed. These are religious people who belong in a parish of one, right? So you've got your own little private religion, you know. That you're not any less religious just because you call yourself spiritual. But Sam Harris in that book is talking about spirituality in a fairly different sense.
Yeah, he's using a different quantitative way in the sense of human self spirit, where it's connected to just, you know, a more humanistic type. I got that straight away, but it was just like kind of an ironic topic or title. I was just like, that's irony.
Yeah, the title I think is both sincere and at the same time
irony. It must be
deliberately provocative, but it's not just to be provocative that he chose that title. I think he actually means to rehabilitate the word spirituality. He thinks that the word spirituality has gotten larded, freighted, invested with a lot of religious ideas about immaterial beings and he thinks the word is absolutely salvageable. There's no other word to describe the universality of certain kinds of experiences that cut across various religious and contemplative traditions. And he thinks that there's, in fact, a phenomenological, psychological world there that is to be explored and can be explored scientifically, very much in the spirit of science, and that there are facts there that are being treated by a lot of secularists as a kind of intellectual pornography because those facts about human psychology and human well-being have traditionally been dealt with only within a religious context, and that we are neglecting an entire important moral chapter of human psychology simply because it has traditionally been in the domain of religion.
It's been co-opted, hasn't it, really, in that regard?
Yeah, that's right, yeah. Well, it hasn't been co-opted, it's just always been there.
Yeah.
And as people have moved away from religion, they said, oh, well, that's the province of religion. So anything that religion... See, it's like this, it's like moral discourse, right? A lot of religious people like to suggest, and a lot of atheists like to say that, you know, rationality and reasonableness and critical thinking, that's the province of the atheists, you know. But a lot of religion, which is ridiculous, is fatuous, but a lot of theists want to say that morality, that's the province of religion and religiosity and theism. And if you don't believe in a God, then you can't be moral and stuff like that. And so they think that they own, you know, moral philosophy. And it's preposterous. I mean, you just go to any university and take a course in moral philosophy and ethics, and you'll find out that there's just tons of non-religious theories. In fact, invariably all the best, almost all the theories of morality, of moral philosophy, are non-religious in character. Mm-hmm. I mean, a religious person is free to use them, right, because it doesn't matter. They're essentially secular. Mm-hmm. But a lot of people who are atheists are so used to hearing moral talk from the mouths of the religious that they'll say there's no such thing as morality. Yeah. Even though they themselves will say you shouldn't do this and you must do that and not to do that and this is right and this is wrong.
No, I've always said morality is objective. It's a set of principles that humans require. There's no getting around that. Now, how we apply them is a bit subjective, but the fact that we own a set of principles that we intrinsically used to guide our moral compass in the sense of reality street, right? They are objective things. Oh no, it is an objective thing, but the set of rules governing them, they're subjective, I think, because we can chop and change when we want. I think ice cream is bad. You think ice cream is good? You know, that's a subjective view on certain situations. But the fact that we all own them, that's the objective part for me, and I've always defended that. Morals are objective, or I shouldn't say morals because that's kind of confusing. The fact that we have a moral set is objective, and I only use that because I like physics and math. You've got to have a set, or it doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, well, I'm also a moral objectivist. I'm a moral realist. I believe in moral facts, that's a very long conversation to have, but I've been having it here and there in recent months. But morality is another domain where atheists sort of run away. They don't want to talk about it. They just want to say, "Oh, morality is subjective. Morality is just personal preferences and stuff like that." And mm-hmm. and I don't think that fleeing into relativism and subjectivism is a sensible approach. But I think a lot of people, a lot of atheists, are just sort of driven from a complete ignorance of moral philosophy into despair. Yeah. And thinking that, well, I don't know how to settle these questions about what's right and wrong if there's no God. Positing a God seems like a quick and dirty way. God said it, so that's what you got to do, right? Divine command theory. Most people, that's the only moral theory they know is divine command theory, whether they're religious or not. And so if they think divine command theory isn't true, they think that's it. They're done. Morality's done. And they won't pick up a textbook on
Thomas Hobbes, Leviathan.
That's a bit of a brick, and
read it anyway. No, it was written in the 16th century, but it's still worthy.
It's a wonderful work. I wouldn't discourage anyone from reading Leviathan, but awesome. I would if anyone's interested in moral philosophy, I'd say just go to any college textbook, you know, Introductory Ethics or Introduction to Moral Philosophy, and just start reading. You know, I mean, some of them are free online, you know, or audiobooks. Yeah, I mean, you will, you know, in a week, know more about moral theories and moral philosophies than practically any of the people, the fundamentalists who are cackling on about how without a God, you know, there's no morality. They'll say things like, objective morality requires a moral lawgiver, and if there's no moral lawgiver, there's no moral law and stuff like that. And like that is,
even if you read about sociology and stuff, which is obviously a little branch of philosophy in that regard, but if you read the sociology aspect of it, then it's actually in our best interest to be nice to each other. Because that's what we do. We want to survive, right? We want to survive as individuals. So it's a good idea not to go around killing people. You know, we've already solved that problem. Well, not yet, but we're getting there.
Yeah, I'm not entirely happy with that kind of approach, though, because that's absolutely true what you said. The thing is that as a foundation for morality, it's not very good, because what it means is that Well, first of all, there are two things. One, there's a question that's being bagged, and then there's the problem that the question that's being bagged is, well, what's so good about getting along with each other? That is, what is morally obligatory about getting along with each other? Sure, I mean, it's nice to get along with people. I mean, I like getting along with people. It's better than not getting along with people. But why is it right or good to get along?
No, there isn't one. That's the problem. That's what Thomas Hobbes said. He was like, well, there's no right or wrong, but it's what's efficient. It's what serves your best interest. And it came down to the individual at that point.
Right, but Hobbes's view is not exactly a robust moral position, because most people would say, well, wait a minute,
he was hated for
what
that
you're saying. Yeah, he sure was, and he was an atheist too. How he got away with it without being killed in that day and age is surprising.
Mid
1600s. And so, I mean, people were being burned as witches at the time, you know. Galileo was under house arrest. You know, Giordano Bruno had just, been burned at the stake not long before. You know, how he did it, I don't know. But anyway, the point is that if you posit as your moral foundation that it's all about sort of getting along with each other and reducing sort of friction, well, that's all well and good. That's a nice pragmatic theory, but it begs the question. Should one do that? Is that the right thing to do? Ought we to do that? And even if you say that we do, well, what happens if you're in a situation where you can not cooperate and just sort of screw over the next person, but you'll never get caught, right? If the whole point is about your own rational self-interest and what works for you, then the moment you can get away with it, then you should defect and you should not cooperate, right? I mean, that was actually Hobbes's position. Hobbes's position was that we need to set up a society where people cannot defect, and you have to create this sort of this figurehead.
He was in favor of like queens and kings and shit, which is kind of funny.
Yeah, it was a firm defense of the principle of kingship and monarchy. Yeah. Authoritarian rule, because without it, you would just have this,
crazy thing called democracy.
Well, I think democracy was at the time was quite unthinkable.
That's why I really like the way I like the way you actually approach it and the way I understand it as well, because it is an ought and it is a how do you deal with that notion kind of thing. And you raised some like crazy points, just like, is murder wrong? And I'm like, what? Like, where did that come from? And he's like, well, it's an ought. It's like, think of the law that we have today. It self-defense, is it wrong to kill somebody? Well, not if you're being attacked. No, it's not. it's perfectly justifiable in that regard. So it kind of overlaps into society in that way. So I really like that book. It's crazy. It did get banned, and that book was banned for a while. When you go to university and you do philosophy, it's actually a required book that you need to read. They won't let you pass any philosophy class really without you reading that book now. It's quite funny.
Well, yeah, you wouldn't get through a political philosophy class without reading that. I wasn't aware that book had ever been indexed or banned. I wasn't aware.
It was. It only for a short time. I mean, bloody hell, they banned Life of Brian and Ireland, for fuck's sake. Like, oh my God, it's controversial, and then, it's funny.
But I'm wondering if Joe had. Oh, sorry, I cut you off. I was just wondering if Joe had a question.
I was just going to say before Joseph does ask some questions, because I know he's there. He's just lurking as usual. There he is. He's just like to listen. That's what I love about my co-host. He's a good listener because he likes to throw some good questions.
Yeah,
but what I'm going to do.
Up all of the Aussie knowledge, but I do have a couple of questions I want to shoot at him after.
Him. All right. Well, before you do that, I just want to tell the people who are watching. We've got 13 viewers who are enjoying themselves. If you guys want to wait maybe 10 minutes so Joseph and Aussie can respond, or a bit more, depending on the length of the questions answers. I'm going to open it up to the rest of the viewers. I will put the link underneath the actual video that you're watching. So just you'll have to refresh the page probably, or if you go on Google Plus, it'll be on there. I'll spam it out to you guys. So and don't forget to add us. This is our own channel. It's not Stizer's channel or Joseph's. It's our new show thing. So you will have to add us. I do apologize for that because we're lazy, basically. So I just want to say that first, and then shoot, Joseph.
Yeah, so I just wanted to because I heard you mention that you're a moral objectivist. So I just wanted to ask, do you believe that there are objective moral truths that people can reach without some sort of objective dictator like a deity? And how would somebody argue for that position? So I want your opinion about it, just curious.
Yeah, sure. Well, I subscribe to something called virtue ethics, or sometimes virtue-based ethics. Broadly speaking, in when you study ethics and moral philosophy, you study different ethical systems. You know, you study, you know, Kant's theory of the categorical imperative. You'll study ethical egoism. You'll study utilitarianism, various forms, and that sort of thing. These are all normative theories, different systems of morality. But then you have to sort of abstract from that and say, well, wait a minute, how do we decide between these competing moral theories, right? And that's the realm, the domain called meta-ethics. And different ethical systems break down into different categories. There's basically consequentialist theories, deontological theories, and virtue theories. I'm a virtue ethicist. So I believe that there are objective moral values, that there are objective moral truths to be discovered. I don't think that that we just sort of sit in a chair and just intuit what are the moral truths. I think that we have to discover these things empirically. I think that one way to look at the story of human civilization is that every culture is basically a living little laboratory, a kind of experiment, a social experiment that's being run on different ways of living, some of which are better than others, that conduce to well-being. So I think that the idea of morality is, the ultimate value behind morality is human flourishing and well-being. Ask yourself, why do we care about morality? Any moral theory has to explain why we care about morality. And, well, then you have to ask, well, why do we care about anything at all? And the important thing is that we do care. There are things that can care. We can care. We can have cares. Okay, well, why does that matter? Well, consider that a stone can't care about anything. A stone's not aware of anything. A stone isn't conscious. A stone doesn't have any mental experiences. It has no first-person subjective mental state. There's nothing that it's like to be a stone. But there's something that it's like to be a fish. There's something that it's like to be a dog. There's something that it's like to be a chimpanzee. There's something that it's like to be Ozzy. Okay? There's a lot that it's like to be me and to be you. And so every person, every subject is a window on the world, is a perspective. There's something that's like to be what you are. You can have mental experiences, and your mental experiences are either positive or negative. You're either enjoying them or you're not enjoying them. They're either making you happy or they're making you unhappy, either short-term or long-term. And that's why we care about anything, right? That's what it is to be able to care about anything. It's to be a subject and to have concerns. Now, given the kinds of critters that we are, we have certain objective biological imperatives, certain interests. There are things that conduce to our happiness and our flourishing and our well-being, and there are things that will immiserate us. All right, and these facts about what will immiserate us or satisfy us and gratify us or frustrate us are objective features of the world. We could be different creatures than we are, right? I could be like Wolverine, for instance. Let's say I were like Wolverine, okay, and I was effectively immortal, you know, I healed so fast. You could walk up, use this example many times, you'd walk up to me and stick a pencil in my guts, right? And it would be terrible if you did it to me, but if I was like Wolverine and you did it, and it would heal and it wouldn't be a problem, it would be at best a minor inconvenience. And supposing it even felt good, right? Suddenly walking up and sticking a pencil in Ozzy's guts would not be a terrible thing. What makes it a terrible thing is that it will make me miserable. But if it wouldn't make me miserable, if it would make me happy, suddenly sticking a pencil in my guts would be a good thing. Right? So there are objective facts about the world and about us, the kinds of critters that we are, that make it the case that certain features, certain actions, certain features of our actions conduce to our flourishing and our well-being. So because I think that morality is about what we care about morality, why we give a damn about morality, why we want morality, why we even talk about morality. And everything that we talk about morality has to do with actions that either conduce towards flourishing and well-being, or whether they conduce towards frustration, unhappiness, and misery. There are objective features of the world. There are ways to live. There are things there that you can do. There are policies that we can recommend that will push us in the direction of happiness and flourishing and well-being, or push us in the opposite direction. And I think that all moral talk is moral talk about those policies that we should adopt, that we can adopt, that will push us in one direction or another. And so I think that moral facts are just facts that supervene on these ordinary mundane facts about what are the predictable consequences of certain actions and policies that we can recommend. And so it's in that sense that I think that there are moral facts and that morality is objective. This is an enormously complicated question, though. It's not a quickly decidable question, right? But it's objective in the sense that it's not up to any particular individual, right? And there are certain things that we care about that matter a lot, and there are things that we care about that matter a little, and there are things that will matter only to me, and there are things that will matter to all of us, right? I like pineapple on my pizza. Maybe you don't, okay? It's not a big deal. It doesn't affect anybody that I like pineapple and that you don't. Consequently, it's just an idiosyncratic difference between us. It's not a moral question, right? But if my liking pineapple and my putting pineapple on pizza had adverse effects on a lot of other people, well, all of a sudden, my actions are of moral concern to other people, right? It's going to matter to them, right? It's the fact that things can matter to us that make questions into moral questions. A universe where there were no beings with minds would be an amoral universe, a universe where morality wouldn't matter, wouldn't apply. Moral questions wouldn't arise, right? Or supposing that here's another thought experiment. Let's imagine that the world is exactly as it is, and we're all in here in this world, but there's an important difference. Nothing can make you happier or worse off than you are. No action that anybody else performs could affect your mental states. Nothing anybody says or anything that they do, no consequence of their actions or behavior could possibly impinge on your mental states and make you one bit happier or worse off. Morality would not arise as a question. The actions and behaviors of other people would simply be a matter of indifference, morally speaking. We simply wouldn't care. It's precisely because our happiness and well-being does rest on how other people act, and how other people's well-being depends or is contingent upon how we act, that we care. We are not solitary spiders. We are social animals with pro-social instincts and pro-social dispositions and behaviors and emotions, and all of these are facts about us. These are biological facts. So our desires rest on our needs, and our needs rest on our biological interests, and our biological interests rest on biological objective features of us and our place in the world. If the world were different, or if we were different, the moral facts would be different. But the moral facts are the moral facts precisely because the world is the way it is and we are the way we are. So it's in that sense that I'm a moral objectivist and I believe in moral facts. But deciding a specific policy, whether this specific policy is to be recommended because it conduces to flourishing and happiness and well-being, that's a thorny question because that's an experiment that has to be carried out. You know, is democracy going to make people happier or will it not? Well, right. The experiment's been tried. I'd say democracies carried out in certain ways under certain conditions is a great thing. Okay, democracies carried out in certain other ways in certain other conditions is not a great thing. Right? It's very, very, very complicated. So to say that the domain of morality is objective is not to say that it's easy to answer. Right? The facts are discoverable. Right? We are with respect to sort of understanding morality. In the position that physics was in 500 years ago. We're just barely getting a glimpse. We're just starting to understand something about human psychology and human brains. We are just starting to understand, logically speaking, philosophically speaking, certain concepts that are important in moral discourse. And so it's no surprise to me that there's a lot of confusion in connection with moral talk and lots of disagreement. But I don't think that we get any closer by positing things like divine command theory, which I think is ultimately a subjectivist theory, not an objectivist theory. Because there all you're doing is you're positing that morality is decided not by me or by you or by a consensus, but by one being. And that now morality consists of trying to perform psychoanalysis on an imaginary being and read its mind and then obey whatever it is that it wants. Right? That, to me, is sort of the ultimate radical subjectivist theory of morality. So the fact that there would only be one mind that to answer to doesn't make it any more objective. Right. So what makes morality objective, in my view, is that it's facts about us and facts about the actual world that conduce to flourishing and happiness and well-being. And if we were constituted completely differently, then the moral facts would be different than they are. But I think the moral facts there to be discovered are what they are because the world is the way it is and we are the way we are.
Okay. I like that answer, actually. That's a really good answer. And I just do have one more question. And while you answer that question, what I'm going to do is open up the room to everybody else. So I'm going to pass around the link on the actual event page, and I'll spread it around, and you guys can join. And so, Ozzy, the last question that I have for you is, so with all of that being said, you know, in terms of how you view objective morality and everything, how is it that you can articulate to other people that claim objective morality from a deity that if they're going to claim objective morality, they must demonstrate it in the same way that you just did for me? How can we possibly like articulate, you know, that to them properly so they can understand what we mean when we say demonstrate your morality is objective simply because it comes from a deity or whatever the claim is, right? People that have those things.
I'm not sure I'm understanding the question. Are you asking me how? I'll let you ask it again.
Yeah, in the way that you just explained it to me, right? That this is how I view morality as being objective. We don't get that from other people that claim objective morality from, like, say, a deity.
Oh, right? Okay, I get you now. Yeah. So what should they do? And how, you know, is that it?
Yeah. How can we try to get it out of them? Like, we're trying to get that same kind of answer, like what you just gave me. So how can we, you know, try to explain that to them, or maybe get them to understand that that's what we want in terms of an answer.
Oh, I really like that question for two reasons. Here's the big reason is this, though. You don't need to get it from them. Too many people worry about what am I going to do when I'm dealing with this person? It doesn't matter about the particular person that you're talking to unless you're really trying to convince that particular person. And if it's just some stranger on the internet, unless you're planning on having 50 conversations over the course of a year with that person, I don't think you need to be terribly invested in this, right? If you want to understand divine command theory, you can just go and pick up a book on the subject, right? You can read a few articles on it. Just go to the Stanford Encyclopedia of Philosophy online. There's stuff to be read. I mean, if you're not satisfied with someone's presentation of the Kalam cosmological argument, or the proof of God from contingency or something like that, and necessity, just go read it online. You know, it's there, right? Go pick up a book. It's there. So I'm not too worried about like how when I'm talking to another person, how I can elicit from them an articulated position. If you want to understand that position, to hell with them. So what? So they're an inarticulate boob who hasn't really studied it up, and they're just parroting some expressions that they've heard from Ravi Zacharias and William Lane Craig or somebody else. You know, who cares, okay? You know, if you want to understand that position because you want to understand it and you want to take it on board and, you know, maybe your intuition is this got to be wrong and you want to see what's wrong with it and try to find fault with it, well, then if you're going to do that, then just go to the source and look it up and read it about it. And don't worry about extracting it, like pulling teeth out of a person who probably doesn't have a fully worked out divine command theory. But I mean, here's something that a divine command theorist could say. A divine command theorist could say, look, imagine that my position is right and that a God exists and that he's omnipotent and he's omniscient. He created the world and he created you in the world and he created you for the world and he created the world for you. Okay? And he knows everything that will make you happy and everything that will make you sad, and he knows that for every person. And he knows that if he were to sort of take it in aggregate, you know, across the greatest number of people, what he knows what would be the rules that one could recommend being omniscient, he would know everything that would make you most happy. He would know what recommendations he needs to write down for you to read, to follow, that which if you would follow them, would make you all as happy as you could be made to be. Okay, such a God, if that being exists, if a God was actually had actually created the world and you in it, and understood what would make you happy and what would make you sad, and what would glorify him, such a being would be in the best possible position to make moral recommendations, right? Would he not? Yes, of course he would, right? And consequently, if such a God exists and issues moral commands, then you'd be a fool not to obey them. And so, if you believe there's a God, and if I can establish that there's a God and that God has this nature, that he's omniscient and he's omnipotent and he created you and that he's benign himself, then you should obey what God says. I mean, it seems to me that a theist could argue that way, such a God would be morally omniscient, would be in the best possible position to make moral recommendations. They might just be rules of thumb. They might not always be the best possible course of action in every particular case, but there's no better recommendation that could be given, unless you want God to sort of whisper the right thing to do moment by moment in every single case for every single person, right? If what you want is rules to live by, the rules have to be finite and they have to be easy to understand and easy to process and generalizable, maybe something like the Ten Commandments or something else, right? And so then a God could do that, right? So that, I think, is a consistent and coherent position. The problem, though, with that is that that's not a definition of objective morality. That's just a reason why, if such a God exists, you should obey his commands, right? But that's right. Not a reason for thinking why what he wants is right, right? He would be, see, in the situation, the scenario that I painted there, God would be effectively reporting to us what would be in our interest from the standpoint of human flourishing and well-being, right? Notice that in this divine command theory that I just put forward, God is reporting to us the policy recommendations from the standpoint of omniscience, right? Knowing all the relevant facts, but he's doing it on the basis of what would conduce to happiness for the greatest number of people, for instance, okay? But so in other words, sort of the ultimate moral value there is human flourishing and well-being, right? But divine command theory doesn't say that that's the ultimate value. Divine command theory says that what is good is doing what God demands or commands. Anything that he commands is good by his very nature, right? Whatever he commands, right? And they would try to then constrain his nature such that he can't command any old thing. He can only command certain things, and those things that he commands are necessarily good whenever he commands them, right? The problem with that, though, is that that's not a theory of morality. That's a vacuous theory of morality. If you say, what is good? God is goodness is whatever God commands. Oh, okay. Well, that doesn't tell me anything, though, because I don't know what God commands. Like, what exactly is it that God commands? Well, you know, the Ten Commandments. Okay, yeah, but why does he command those things? What makes them good? That God commanded them? Well, what if he'd written the commandments the opposite way? Would that be good? Well, let's say, no, he couldn't have written them the other way. Okay. So, in other words, the reason that we ought to obey the commands is that they are good commands. And what makes them good commands is that he commanded them. But then you end up with the Euthyphro dilemma, right? So they will sometimes try to sort of say that God's nature is in and of itself intrinsically good. Okay. But now what you're doing is you're not telling me anything about goodness. You're just telling me that goodness is godness, right? But why is godness good?
Right.
Right? Wait a minute. You're the whole point is you're supposed to analyze and explain the concept of goodness in terms of something that isn't goodness that will allow me to understand what goodness is. And you're telling me that goodness is God's nature. But what is God's nature? You've answered the question of what is goodness if you tell me what God's nature is, and I know what God's nature is. But now you have to articulate what God's nature is, right? But if you haven't done that, then you've left the concept of goodness empty, right? It's like when they say that, God explains logic. Why? Because God is by nature logical, right? Look, to the extent that I understand what it means for something to be logical, then I understand what it is when you say that God is logical. To the extent that I understand what morality is, I know what it is when you say, I know what you mean when you say God is moral, right? When you say God is moral, you're telling me something about God to the extent that I already understand something about morality. But if the concept I want to understand is the concept of morality itself, what it means, you can't explain it in terms of God unless there's something in the concept of God that explains what morality, why morality is the way it is, why the moral order is the way it is. So I don't think that they can articulate a conception of morality in terms of divine command theory and divine nature. If I want to understand what morality is, you have to tell me something other than morality is whatever God's nature happens to be, right? Because I can always ask the question, what's so good about God's nature?
Right.
Right? And so there's this thing called, in moral philosophy, called the open question. G.E. Moore was a philosopher of the early 20th century who coined the expression naturalistic fallacy, not to be confused with Hume's is odd fallacy or is odd problem. The naturalistic fallacy stems from this something called the open question. One can always ask, what makes something good? You know, if I say, charity is good. Oh, well, why is charity good? Well, because it helps people. Okay, well, what makes helping people good? Well, it makes people feel better. Well, what makes people feel better? It makes them happy. Well, okay, well, what's so good about happiness? What makes happiness good? And on and on and on. You can always ask the open question. Always. That's true. That's an objection that can be raised against my view or any view. The open question is open. It's always there. You can always ask it. And you can ask it even if you posit a God, and you posit a God with a morally good nature. You can always ask what's good about his nature. And it beggars the same problem. So a lot of theists will sort of throw the open question problem at you without realizing that they don't have an answer to that question. Right. Nobody's got an answer to that question. You can always ask the question. The question that should be asked in response to that question is, well, wait a minute. What do we want a moral theory for? Right? And I think my view answers that. My view actually explains why we give a damn about morality. Right? It comes down to the well-being of sentient creatures, creatures that can be objects of moral concern and that can deliberate between courses of action and can understand the predictable consequences of their actions and consequently can anticipate the effects upon the mental states of other sentient beings, other objects of mental concern. Mm-hmm. So I think I've got an answer to the question why we give a damn about morality that sort of ends up blocking but not ultimately answering the open question. Because you can always answer the question, well, why should we care about the well-being of other organisms? But I would argue that there's nothing else about which one could be concerned. If you're not concerned about your own well-being, what's going to happen? Well, first of all, you're not going to be here for very long. Organisms that are not concerned about their own well-being have a tendency not to act in service of their own well-being and have a tendency to disappear. Good for them. they really have no business here. but the fact is that there's something that it's like to be something. That fact, that there is something that it's like to be a thing, that you can is what makes it the case that you can have interests, and that those interests can be served, and those interests determine your needs, and those determine your wants and your higher level wants and desires, and so everything follows from this basic fact about the world that do exist systems, physical systems in the world, where there's something that it's like to be that, and consequently things can matter to such a thing. There are systems to which things matter. Things matter to this system. Things don't matter to this system, right? And that's why this is not an object of moral concern, right? But I am an object of moral concern, and you are an object of moral concern, and dogs are objects of moral concern because they can, their mental states can be changed. Okay. And so when a person says, yes, but, you know, what's so good about flourishing and well-being, that's really asking, why do you care about the fact that you care? Right? What do you mean? How can I not care about what I care? It's all about having concerns, about having interests, about caring one way or the other. But positing a God that just by his nature is good doesn't solve the open question problem. You can always ask, what's good about his nature? Right? And then if you just say, well, it just is good. Well, okay, but then you haven't answered the question. I could say that about anything. At any point, anybody could say, happiness is good, or charity is good. Well, what's so good about it? It just is good. You could just end the conversation there. You can't just arbitrarily end the conversation there. You have to have a reason why you think you have got a principled block on the open question, where you can say, wait a minute, now the open question is perverse. To ask the open question at this point is perverse. To ask, why is it good to care about yourself, for instance, okay, I think is a perverse question. I mean, just consider if the answer is, oh, it's not, right? What's going to happen, right? But just look at what people are concerned about in moral philosophy, right? Or just in ordinary moral talk, in all moral discourse, what are people concerned about? They're concerned about the consequences of their actions on the mental states of other beings that can have mental states. That's what they're concerned about. That's what morality is about. That is the subject of morality. And a moral theory has to account for that, has to be reducible to that. And I think that positing divine command theory doesn't do that. So I don't think that you're in a conversation with a typical theist who believes in divine command theory, that they're going to be able to address that. But it should be said that, I mean, a sophisticated theist doesn't have to believe in divine command theory, right? I mean, I know lots of theists who reject divine command theory as ridiculous, right? As sort of an archaic, simplistic, legalistic model of morality, and they favor a deontological theory. Some of them are consequentialists. A lot of them are virtue ethicists. So, you know, you don't have to subscribe to divine command theory just because you're a theist.
Yeah. Okay. Well, that was excellent. Like, because I really was curious about that and how you could possibly go about it. Because it kind of, one of the reasons why I asked it, and I want to welcome Chris, Marty, welcome to the room.
Hey, Chris.
Hello.
And yeah, the reason why I bring it up is because we hear a lot when we're having conversations about morality, people are always going, well, you can't account for why I should care. You know, like, why should I care about what you think, sort of attitude, right? Why should I care about what you think well-being is? How, you know what I mean? So I was curious to hear your point of view as to how we could possibly go through that kind of dialogue.
Well, that is a good question. It's an important question. Why should I care about the well-being of others, right? That question has an answer, right? It's not, I mean, like all my answers, they're long and a little tedious, but there is an answer to that question, right? But I don't think divine command theory answers that question at all either, right? Divine command theory doesn't answer the question. Here's a question you can ask a divine command theorist, okay? Why should I obey God? Well, because he's good. Why should I obey a being that is good? Well, you just should. Well, why? Is there a rule that says I have to obey God? Okay, let's say that there is. Is there a meta rule that says that I have to obey the rule that says you have to obey God? Do I have to obey the rule that says you have to obey the rule that you have to obey the rule that you obey God? You see the regress that goes on here? As soon as a person posits divine command theory, what they're saying is that morality consists of the following of a rule. But one has to ask, what's good about the rule? What's good about following the command? Right? You can ask the question, the open question, what's so good about following this command? Why is that good? Oh, well, you just should. It's good. Okay, well, why? It's intrinsically good? Well, wait a minute. If you can just arbitrarily at any point say it's intrinsically good, you need a reason. And they'll usually try to say, well, it's because the command comes from God. What's good about obeying God's commands? Is there a meta, higher principle that says that you have to obey the commands if they come from a God? Let's say there is. Why do I have to obey that meta principle, that command that says that you must obey the commands that come from a God? Why should I obey that? Is there a meta command that says that I have to obey the command that says that you have to obey the command that issues from a god? I mean, it just never ends, right? This the justificatory regress, the justificatory moral regress problem is always going to be present, and you don't get around it by positing a god. It just right. The problem is absolutely not stopped. It is there exactly like it was before you posited a god. So that's why I think that's completely dissatisfying. All divine command theories, I think, are sort of dead in the water. But most people don't think it through. They're just used to thinking of morality in terms of marching orders. Mm-hmm. And what the reason they like marching orders is because they think it makes it easy. It makes morality quick and dirty. It allows them to have a decision procedure on what to do. What most people are really, really anxious about in moral talk is not how I justify what's right and wrong. It's just, what the hell do I do? I just want an answer. I just want to know what to do. You know, if my daughter comes home pregnant, what do I do? Should I feel good about it or bad about it? Should I help or should I kick her out of the house? Yeah. Right? If a friend is going to have an abortion, what should I tell her? You know, what should I tell her? Right? If a friend of mine is on drugs or cheating or on a spouse or something, what should I recommend? Should I disapprove or should I approve? Should I be compassionate or you know, should I tattle or should I keep it to myself? You know, what do I do? People want to know what to do, right? And one of the things about divine command theory is these are theories that are invariably lined up with religions that have a book or a tradition that purports to have all the answers. And the nice thing, the appeal of divine command theory is that it's used to justify a lookup procedure. Oh, I'll just look it up in the big book of moral answers, right? That's what people find rewarding and satisfying. That, I think, is what is so attractive to it. And that, I think, is why people are so anxious when you question, people who believe that get so anxious when you question whether or not there's a God. If you start questioning that there's a God, then you're questioning their lookup procedure. And now they find themselves bereft of moral answers. They don't have a procedure. They haven't got a clue. How do you engage in moral reasoning? Moral reasoning was easy. All I had to do was read the mind of God. And I had a book that told me most of what God wanted. So most of the answers were there. And the ones that weren't there, I could sort of figure them out and infer them from other answers and maybe talk to some people who had, you know, and that's how they did it. There's no real intellectual heavy lifting in moral reasoning when you're using divine command theory. It's all easy. It's all quick and dirty. In fact, I have a video on my channel called Divine Command Theory Cripples Moral Reasoning. I think that divine command theory cripples a person's moral imagination. The more a person and the longer a person has been under the spell of divine command theory, the harder it is for them to imagine how a person even engages in moral reasoning who doesn't believe in a God, which is why they're always saying, if there's no God, how can you possibly – they haven't a clue. They're not being fatuous or anything like that. They're not being insincere. They don't have a clue. Their moral imagination has atrophied down to nothing. If there's not a lookup procedure in a book or a religious tradition, they don't know how to reason morally. They don't know how to do a moral calculus. They don't know what factors they should be taking into account.
Yeah, I've met plenty of people like that, and it's quite, like, it does saddens my heart a little bit that they can't even kind of figure out even a simple way to try to think in those terms, like, well, yeah, maybe you could do this or handle that way or something like that, but yeah, you're right. It's not on purpose. They're not, you know, playing a game. It's they actually have never considered that possibility of actually, you know, reasoning.
Yeah, I think it's an important moral liability. I think this is one of the reasons why it's actually important to get people to understand the problems with certain fundamentalist religions, because fundamentalist religions are almost always supporting divine command theory. And so it's one of the actually morally important, morally consequential problems with fundamentalism. It isn't just that they've got like a lot of ridiculous beliefs about science and, you know, a science-denying anti-intellectual attitude. It's that their moral imagination is enslaved. They really are almost incapacitated in their moral imagination through a lifetime of slavish adherence to the idea that morality consists of marching orders and that the marching orders are written down and that's all you've got to do. God said it, you know, that settles it, you know, I'm doing it. And I mean, that is really unfortunate. That's a pernicious effect of fundamentalism, is that that kind of reasoning.
All right. Well, thank you for all of that, Ozzy. I just want to welcome, we got Chris Maudie here and the beautiful reality. If you all want to add something, or if you want to ask Ozzy any questions about the content you heard, or if you want to ask me or Styles or any questions about anything, just it's open forum, so feel free to just go away, gentlemen. So,
if you don't mind, I'd like to ask a question as to, and this is directed at Ozzy. I don't know if I've ever heard you talk about this, but you know, like in developmental psychology, you know, children pass through a moral development, and one of those stages, and I forget the name of it, and I'm thinking of Kohlberg's specifically.
Yeah, I'm familiar with it. Yeah, I couldn't name them, but I know Kohlberg's work.
I pulled it up real quick, but then you know, Hold My Unicorn calls on me right when I'm trying to figure it out. But one of the stages, obviously, is to reduce punishment and maximize reward from an authority figure, right? And that's which do you think is worse? What is it? Divine command theory, where they're like just being told do this because it's moral, just and it's following instructions, as compared to, well, I'm doing this because I want to get to heaven, maximize reward, and avoid going to hell, you know, like prevent punishment of some sort, right? Because, you know, this almost follows a Maslow-like self-actualization where ultimately, after development, if you have properly gone through all the stages, you are acting moral out of an internal compulsion to do good, reduce harm, and be a humanitarian, if you will. So that was a long way to ask a pretty simple question. Which do you think would be worse, like following instructions because they are instructions, or having a childish version of acting moral?
I think having a childish childish attitude of acting moral just based on reward and punishment, I think, would be worse. But I mean, it's the fact is, when it comes to divine command theory, you get both. Divine command theory is a theory that is almost always accompanied with a simple, you know, carrot and stick incentive. So the theories that you're talking about, people like Kohlberg and Maslow, these are hierarchical theories of human psychological and social development. So, I mean, a child, for instance, at first doesn't have any real concept of right and wrong. It has some pro-social instincts and pro-social tendencies and behaviors and emotions, but it's not really sort of trying to follow any rules. It doesn't have any principles. Children are basically, you know, quite selfish, and that's why we have to educate them and civilize them. they're pretty uncivil when they start off. The way we do this at first is reward and punishment, reward and punishment, reward and punishment. You know, we tell them what to do, we tell them what not to do, and we reward and punish accordingly. And the child at first is just sort of trying to avoid punishment and trying to obtain rewards. It's just like your cat or your dog learning a trick, you know. But at some point, the child starts to internalize the rewarder and punishment. The rewards and punishment. It takes them on board. It learns them, and your sort of the voice of the parent, so to speak, gets internalized. It carries it around, right? This is sort of the beginnings of a conscience. This all gets internalized, and so that a child no longer actually needs to have the parent there telling them not to do it. They can now actualize the voice of activate the voice of the parent in their head and obey the instructions, right? But then at some point the child starts to understand the reasons why the rules are there and starts to see the sense in the rules, and then now is sort of moving up the ladder here, again taking up another big step where the child is obeying the rules because of an understanding of why the rules are the rules to begin with. Not just following the rules for the sake of following the rules out of habit or out of fear for desire of a reward, but out of a genuine understanding of the rationale for the rules, right? That is, of course, a higher stage, right? And I think you can go even beyond that, actually. I think sort of virtue ethics takes you sort of well beyond that. There are reasons for moral conduct that can actually transcend rules so that you don't even have to be too fussy about the rules. So one of the maxims that I live by is that, you know, rules are for people that don't have virtues. Once you've inculcated and cultivated certain virtues in yourself, you don't have to be too hidebound by the rules. You don't have to live, you know, by the book anymore. You know when the book applies and when the book doesn't apply. So I think, to answer your question, I think that it's better for a person to just be blindly following the rules than just blindly acting out of naked self-interest all the time and trying to avoid punishment and obtain rewards. I think that is the crassest form. That a person who is just trying to avoid punishment and obtain rewards is not a moral agent at all. That is a purely selfish agent. Right? I mean, a sociopath of the worst sort can be operating that way. Your dog operates that way. That's not a real moral agent yet. That's a step on the way to moral agency. The person that is at least following the rules is now taking himself out of the equation and is trying to not act only out of his self-interest, but in allegiance to a principle, right? Mm-hmm. And so I think that's actually a step up, but I don't think it's you shouldn't stop there. And I think so the divine command theory has a tendency to urge you to stop right there.
I have two comments. One is, I love the fact that you use the dog-cat example, because jokingly I say, you know, like, kids are animals. Kids are animals, essentially, until they reach a certain age. You know, animals don't internalize. You know, that's not part of their development, but kids do. Until they internalize, they're just animals, right?
Yeah.
I say that jokingly, but I'm glad that you kind of it doesn't sound like you disagree. We're all animals, of course. I'm being very obnoxious right now. The second thing I wanted to bring up was, I didn't bring that up to simplify. You know, the religious people are just trying to avoid hell and get into heaven. But to this day, adults, and I hear them say, you know, like, they'll engage with me as an atheist, and then at the end they're like, but you know, Chris, there are consequences.
Right.
You know what I mean? It's like, that is a legit argument still used by grown-ass adults.
And it's used as if it's like a huge showstopper, you know, like, you should take this into consideration from me because I'm telling you, and there are consequences, so be afraid. Be very afraid.
But even if they didn't hold themselves as an authority figure, they're just reminding you that there is a punishment that you should avoid and a reward that you should want to gain.
Exactly.
That's why you should be doing the things that I think you should be doing and be afraid of that punishment because it's eternal.
There was
that's weird to me.
There was a hangout yesterday that I was involved in, where a gentleman was he was with us, and pardon all the noise going off back here. He was with us for a while before he dropped out. I guess he probably felt offended that we all was able to express that, you know, we have this content in life without, you know, needing this threat of, you know, punishment. But he asked me, you know, what is it that I look forward to? Or why should I care for the betterment of society? And my favorite answer is to go and to talk about my idea sense of a better society. What does a better society look like? Or what's an ideal for a better society for me? And for me, a better society would include educated people, more morally sane people that can take a moral situation and make the right choices and not do it based off of what they believe, you know, that they are commanded to do because of some, you know, ancient book. But, we were trying to express that to this gentleman. Sorry about that, my phone. We were trying to express this to the gentleman, and he just couldn't quite grasp it, and I think that's heartbreaking. I think the first thing... you know, especially if you're engaging with people, like in general, if you're engaging with someone that's like this, I think the best thing you can do is to, I wouldn't say go about it, you know, daintily, you know, and you know, all soft and whatnot, but perhaps maybe go about it in a way that it's cut and clear that, hey, this is silly to me, and this is unnecessary, and I tell you why, without trying to be insulting or, you know, trying to offend the other person. But I think it's a good start, especially to have that productive conversation, you know what I mean? To especially try to knock down certain points and, you know, certain aspects of this, you know, this command theory, you know, just do as I say, not as I do type thing, you know what I mean? I think it's helpful for me. I don't know about you guys if you tried that approach. Just to make it cut clear that this is why I don't use this, and this is why I find it unnecessary to think like this. Does that make sense?
Well, I certainly don't pull any punches when I'm discussing moral philosophy with people who support divine command theory. I mean, I like to sort of, I usually like to make people feel the full weight of my incredulity, of the horror I feel at the crassness of their morality. I mean, they think so highly of their morality because they think they are dutiful servants of a morally perfect being, and I see them for the most part, not all of them, but a lot of people who are like this as essentially unthinking slaves who are just not bothering to think through the implications of their position. So I mean, I'm fairly polite and soft-spoken, but I think I'm fairly forceful when I talk to people and get them to feel that, you know, your position doesn't seem moral to me at all. It seems childlike.
I think it's necessary. Seems like, to be like
yeah, I think they need to understand that they don't occupy the moral high ground that they think that they do.
Mm-hmm.
That from our standpoint as non-believers. They are just knuckling under to an arbitrary tyrant that they have declared to be good, but they don't know how to justify it as good. They've just defined him as good. And whatever he orders is good, whether it's slavery or the massacre of infants or whatever, you know. Mm-hmm. You know, whatever he decrees is the good thing when he decrees it. And those people, I think, are just biting the bullet on a really unpleasant consequence. They wish that their holy texts weren't filled with preposterous moral recommendations. I mean, you know, there isn't a line in the Bible that says, "Thou shalt not own other people." You know,
right.
The Bible. There's room in the Bible for that, right? I mean, one line couldn't have been added, right?
Yeah,
I mean, there's room in the Bible to tell you, "Thou shalt not suffer a witch to live." And there's a line in there warning you against an imaginary crime. But there's no room in the Bible to tell you, don't own people, okay? You may live in a slave-owning society, but you, my people, don't own people, right?
There's nothing in there also to, to backtrack a little bit, it's just to kind of tack on. But, I mean, even for, like, the Ten Commandments, you got a few of them that appeals to this deity's own, you know, vanity, which is useless, you know, in the big picture. But then you don't have thou shalt not rape or, you know, anything that will actually become useful information. In fact, it's you know, kind of advertising this thing, you know what I mean? But yeah, I just wanted to add that in there. Good night, Christopher.
Thank you, sir. Oh, sorry, I missed him. Gentlemen, I have to get going. I've been going for a little more than 2 hours here, and I've been doing a lot of yapping. And I'm running out of voice.
No, Ozzy, thank you very much for coming again. I know the last time it was kind of blah, but this time it was much better. We got to hear you speak more rather than argue with people.
No, that was fine. I enjoyed that last time, too. but I'm running out of voice here. It's getting a little late. Anyway, but
no problem.
Thank you very much. This was a fun discussion. I really appreciate the opportunity to get my dinner. I really like that. Thank you so much.
Yeah, for sure. Anytime again, have a good night, Ozzy.
Okay. Good night, gentlemen.
Good night.
And I don't know where the fuck Stizer is.
Stizer, Stiggy. You talking about Stiggy? Shop.
And he said 10 minutes, 20 minutes ago. But for people still watching, the join link is on the fucking YouTube video and on the event channel and on various places that I've posted, and if you want, Alex, you can share it too.
Oh yeah, I've just stopped by for a little bit because I seen that you guys were holding it down in here. I kind of wanted to vent a little bit too, but I might want to just wait for another platform to do that.
Well, that's what this one's kind of for, so if you want to, feel free, because it's always whatever.
Yeah, it was about a particular person.
So go ahead. Who is it? Stizer loves that shit.
Well, I wanted to rant about, you guys probably know her, and she goes by Candy.
Candy Johnson.
Yeah, you know, for the longest time, I've been, sorry, that's my dad yelling, hold on.
Well, yeah, I'm familiar with Candy Johnson. She's kind of crazy, but it's okay. We deal with crazy people all the time. And that's just how it goes around here on the YouTube Google Plus community.
Well, that was annoying. Sorry. So you're familiar with her. She's doing a hangout now, right? With there was a guy at GC that just invited me to that hangout. And I wanted to join, but apparently I'm blocked by somebody. I assume it was Candy that blocked me.
Oh wow, why did that happen?
Well, you've missed it. So a few months ago, there was a hangout that she did and I joined, and being that she logically doesn't understand that all of her arguments doesn't work logically, and when I walked her down to why those arguments didn't work, she didn't like it or was too stupid to understand why it didn't work. And so she was resulted, you know, yelling and screaming and not letting me talk. She did the same thing to Drag as well the following day. Anyway, she's just not the smartest person you ever come across.
Well, I know. I've been repeatedly attacked by Candy on numerous occasions about very silly things, and
she's so harmless.
She's a huge pain in the ass.
She is, but she's I to the point where I ignore her. And I've been ignoring her. And the funny part was, right after that hangout, I only did one post about her and one comment about her. And that was it, right?
I didn't even give her the time of day.
right. Barely even paying attention to her. And then she posts all the stuff. She's like, you need to stop attacking me. And I'm like, you probably have like 1,000 little things that you tag me in that I'm not paying you any attention, really. My guy GC that's in that hangout, I just played the hangout for a little bit. I couldn't bear it. It was Candy being ignorant, yelling over him, talking over him. I hear him trying to be logical, and of course he's probably just a smart guy, probably way too smart for them. And my heart breaks for him because it's like, dude, just get out of there. You're wasting your time with them. They're morons. You know, Candy Johnson is just a... I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I have to say this, but like, I've been patient enough, right? You know, where I don't just call people names for the hell of it. Usually, if I'm doing that, you deserve point blank. Right.
I've noticed that there are a lot of new characters popping up around. Like there are a lot of new faces that are just coming and rearing their heads.
Yeah.
On both sides of the argument, not just, you know. But I've recently called Candy the female version of G-Man. You know, she's like the female equivalent.
G-Man.
Should I say hello? I am back, finally. With y'all.
All right.
A lot longer than I thought you would be to buy a bottle of fucking vodka. Hello to
Stizer,
motherfucker Stizer, over there, Stizer, my Stizer, beautiful friend.
Stizer, you've lost your pilot's license.
Dude, I lost my fucking bank card. Like, seriously, I'm like, oh my god.
You go to the store to go get some shit. The world just
ended, seriously. So, I didn't get to say goodbye to Ozzy Mandis, and I seen Christopher Malty popped in.
Yeah, you missed it, man.
Yeah, you missed it, man.
Tail end of our intellectual discourse. Now we're on some of the bullshit.
Oh, well, yeah, that's
now,
good.
Now we're here for the ranty.
Yeah. The link's shared.
Super fun time now.
Yeah. The link's shared.
You guys want to join? I know I've shared the link, but Stizer, if you want to share the link some more.
Yeah, I will share some more.
Share the link some more.
Right, I'm gonna put it underneath the actual live. In fact, maybe that's a bad idea, actually, because you can come back.
Well, I put it on the... I already put one on the YouTube.
Really? Oh, then well, if you got randoms, we just kick them.
Oh, you kicked them. You don't. Yo, you didn't give me.
Yeah, you have. I give you the ages ago. You've got that. Anyway, yeah, so welcome to Chocolate. Oh, he's disappeared, little stoner. And welcome to Cyprian as well. Hello, Cyprian. How are you doing? A good Russian friend.
I'm doing like this, you know. I'm having a beer. You're always having a beer.
You're always as drunk as fuck.
I'm always drunk as fuck. That's the way I roll, bitch.
or the way you wobble, more like.
Right, yeah. The way you wobble.
That's the way I wobble, yeah. I'm fine for me. Fuck that shit.
Stumble and fall over, maybe.
Your motherfuckers know that. This dude, Stizer?
Fuck Stizer.
He's a fucking prick. You know him.
Well, you're well aware of that.
So, beautiful. Anyway, I will apologize for missing the recent hangout you did. It's just, you know.
Oh, no, no. I'm random when it comes to that. So I do it just right spur of the moment, which is kind of the point of it, I guess.
No, but you always have cool hangouts, though.
I just think they're sloppy. I don't know why people like them so much.
Well, if you got nice personalities in the room and all that good stuff, it's always fun.
Yeah, so you got me.
That's your nice personality in the room.
There we go. See, there we go. Right, we got our person.
You know, Stein knows that.
Yeah, I'm a pro.
No, he's not.
I'm a pro being nice.
See, Stizer is our douche. He's a douche, but he's our douche.
Lest we forget
about Hatgate, we must continue supporting Scholar Fiction and being able to wear hats indoors, especially indoors.
It was a pleasure. I need a hat.
This is a serious problem, and it's not going to go away anytime soon. It's not funny, you guys. Stop fucking laughing. I'm being dead serious. Stop fucking around. You're pissing me off.
Oh, man.
See, I feel left out. I haven't even got a hat. I just feel so left out.
I love the banded hat that he has, though. Like, I wish I had that. I had a hat around here somewhere.
Whatever, I see my Guy Fawkes costume.
Everybody, stop fucking funny.
Thank you, Patrick. Thank you, Patrick, for sympathizing with me. It's not funny.
Fuck you, Patrick. We painted Pluto on the fucking sky.
Hold on,
Stizer. Before you say anything, I just want to say to Patrick, the other day with MA, and I think it was Brojo's room, that was brilliant. Thank you very much. I know that you rage quit, but it was enjoyable to watch you just
Conspiracy theorist.
Yeah, it was so ridiculous. Like
it. It's because he's our resident astronomer, man. We got our resident astronomer Patrick. We got our resident flat Earth doomsday ass kicker, which is Rechlin.
That's right. I came here for an argument.
That's right.
Unfortunately for you, there's no one here to argue with.
Yeah. So just drink some wine. Someone will show up eventually.
I'm actually down to soda right now.
Oh, that's bad.
I'm out of wine. I'm out of beer.
FEMA camp right there. FEMA camp.
Motherfucker, you have a beer on me.
There you go. See, there's a nice guy.
He's a socialist.
Yeah, but we haven't figured out how to transport that through the system.
Yes. Well, not yet, but I keep hope for Star Trek style shit.
See what happens when you have a socialist economy, though? People just want to give you shit.
I wanna put this out there for future people. Hey, future people, if you can develop something where I can, like, give people something digitally but physically at the same time.
Yeah. Well, they're called 3D printers, but they're so expensive, it's not happening yet. We'll be able to 3D print our own booze and shit soon, probably.
Oh wow. Oh, the beautiful reality. Is that you? Is that like you on camera?
That's me on camera.
Holy shit. I've never seen you on camera before.
Oh, yeah. That's rare, man. That's rare.
I love you, guy. Man. You're right. Fucking A, man. I never saw you on camera.
I'm sorry. You shut the fuck up for a second.
I'm barely.
Is this motherfucker a superstar?
Porn star.
Oh, no.
Yes, he is. He's a
legitimate porno star. Yeah.
Yeah, he's got a big, giant, black fucking
Betty.
Over-exaggerating. Stereotypical black.
Jesus Christ. Over-exaggerating. I kid you. That's what that is.
Not by 7 centimeters. Are you kidding me, dude?
I'm sorry. I don't remember your actual name, but Beautiful Reality, I've always loved your stuff.
His porno name is Big Black Hat.
No, really. I want to say that you're amazing. I've never seen you on camera before, but your stuff is cool. It's like I've always subscribed to your stuff, and it's cool to see you on camera for a change.
I appreciate it, man. I don't think I've ever been on camera talking to you before, so that's pretty. It's dope, man.
This is me.
It was old piss.
Nah, man, it was like a young fucking Cassius is clean, man.
Drunks and stoners in the room. I'm happy now, man. I'm happy we got all the drunks and stoners in the room. High five.
Yeah, hold on one second.
Yeah, all the people with bleak futures.
Let's not get too negative.
You don't want to talk about future, man. I'm getting no future. I'm 54. She's 65. There's like no fuck, man. You know what I mean? I don't know. You know what I mean? That's like winning the lottery 4 times over. You know what I mean? But I'm going to enjoy the
real winners in here, man.
Just as much as I enjoy the last 20.
Yeah, you know, I won the lottery 4 times. It was like, first time it was like $12, second time it was like $62.
Oh, jeez. Hold on, I'll be right back, guys. I gotta grab something to eat. I get some food here.
Oh, love it. How did you manage to get him in there? This is cool.
No, he just showed up, man. Shared the link and he popped in.
So what the fuck is up, guys?
I'll tell you, Pops, Patrick, you know what I mean? You can get me any time. All you got to do is you just got to get in touch with my main man, you know what I mean? And he'll get me in here, you know what I mean? No problem.
Okay. I think.
Like, <yeah. laughs>
okay.
Whatever.
Just like talking to Stizo.
Yeah, I'm just talking shit, man. You know, Stizo and me, I mean, I'm a Scottish fucker, you know what I mean? But I believe in life, believe in science, believe in people, I believe in love, but love is like, you know, money and sex and drugs, you know, that's money, you know. And drugs, you know, that's love, you know what I mean?
That's all science. It's science. You said science and some other
shit. Money and sex, like money and drugs.
It's all science. It's all science.
Well, I don't know. I'm down to Pepsi Cola and over the counter drugs.
I'm down to you.
Ibuprofen to make sure I don't wake up with a hangover.
Well, alcohol dissolves better than alcohol. You know what I mean?
I finished all my alcohol and I took a couple of ibuprofens to make sure I don't wake up with a hangover.
Oh my!
And I'm drinking it down with Pepsi.
There's an easy solution.
I've just got to say, like, no, Patrick, you're the same age as me. You like when it's raining outside, you wake up and your knees and your ankles ache a bit. You know what I mean? You don't want to take those pills, you know what I mean? So maybe you just have a little swig of fucking alcohol, just to ease the pain in your knee and your
Yeah, The trouble is I just finished all my alcohol.
Yeah. I'm not a drug addict. You just a little bit of alcohol just to take that. Just to ease that pain, you know what I mean? That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, I agree. But the trouble is I just ran out.
He hasn't got any. He's fucked, is what he is. He's fucked.
I'm coming up with a proposal. Should we leave the old timers get together and make a different chat, maybe?
I just got here and Cyprian's trying to get rid of me.
Yeah.
No, Cyprian's trying to poach our fucking guest. Fuck you.
Let's go into our little private room, guys, and talk about older guys' stuff.
Yeah, like being old guys. And shit. and erections.
So what I'm proposing, let's leave Patrick and I'm sorry.
His name's Tercy, silly bastard.
Let's just leave Patrick and Tercy enjoy their old time jokes like when they were young, back in the 1920s, you know. And enjoy.
I was born in 1959.
I'm kidding, but yeah.
Back in our day, we had sticks to play with. Yeah, that won't be cool.
Cyprian, I'm disappointed in you. You're trying to get rid of me now.
No, I'm just
He's just drunk. He's always drunk.
Always Coca-Cola. Oh, sorry, always beer.
Yeah, I was going to say cheers. What the fuck, Coca-Cola? What are you on about?
Fuck American Coca-Cola. You're Russian. What the fuck? American, Pepsi, some fucking thing. You know what I mean? Fuck me.
I honest to God, I just ran out of my beer. I just ran out of the wine. I had to drink something, so I
I can see some
Pepsi and.
Before you know if I get mental, I'm probably gonna take this off air in like 20 minutes just to give you a warning. It's just because we've reached a 3-hour mark and that seems a bit fair.
Oh, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I was in another hangout.
And we never got the chance to talk about sex with all these.
You've got 20 minutes. You've got 20 minutes, which is 17 more minutes longer than you last. So, you know, be my guest.
Patrick,
you like that one, right?
I talked to your sister. She says you're a burn ward. Come on, you know what I mean? Yeah.
You like that one. But it's still open. Ward? Yeah, if that's anybody wants to join.
I don't know. I'm ready for the intellectuals because
so
I just.
My question would be like this. What was sex in the 40s?
Beyond, I don't know. I was born in 1959.
Can we talk about science and religion and how I don't want to talk about how much better your booze is. We all get drunk. We could just eat fucking rotten fruit and get drunk. You know what I mean? That's what we used to do when we were mates. You know
is anybody excited for to see Pluto in high definition? I am.
I want to see Pluto and hide. But I want to land on Pluto and talk to the people that live there. You know what I mean?
They're probably trying to fuck off.
People that live there.
They're probably trying to fuck off.
Somebody here has been drinking a lot more than I have. I think his name is
Terse. He's a fucking islander.
I'm not satisfied with the photos from Pluto.
It's getting better every day.
I think they photoshopped it. It's not real pictures.
Real picture. It's one of Jupiter. Someone said conspiracy.
You can't even get pictures of the fucking Earth. Okay, you can't even get live. Live video of the Earth.
Hold my! I've got huge, gigantic fucking pictures of Earth, you know what I mean? And I don't even live on Earth! I'm a fucking amazing, crazy, fucking Mars, fucking crazy, you know, living on the moon, cunt, you know?
Alright, cheers, calm down. Calm down.
What's fucked up is I'm starting to feel like him. Like Thursday right now. I'm about to rip my shirt off.
Yeah, but you're Russian and black! You're Russian and black! You got a few bad! Be Russian bad! You should be a scientist! You should be up on the fucking space!
I just ripped my shirt.
That's just cost you like $4.
That's training for the moon. That is. That's training for the moon.
Some poor bastard in China sold that and got paid 50
yen. Maybe in retrospect, that's not the best thing you've ever done.
For the viewers, there are two sides to society. This is the second half. We had the first half at the beginning of the show with Ozzy.
And then there's the other.
And then we're gonna host degradation of society.
The decline of mankind.
Yeah.
I have two cats. I can tear one of them into two parts, you know what I mean? Which one do you want me to tear into two parts to prove I am? I deserve to be on the moon.
I think I'm jealous because I got the same color shirt that Terrace has. But mine isn't as cool as his. I can't do that. How did he change so fast? I can't do that. Like
10, I just got another one.
I'm just trying to say, my friend, I have a black shirt and you are a red shirt. But now we have a different shirt. We have a different shirt there.
Anybody from America who thinks I speak Scottish, that's Scottish. I speak English.
I've noticed that.
Oh my god. That's Scottish.
I was trying to make a joke, but I didn't even finish the joke before it got changed. It's like I was making a joke about his shirt being like all this nice rim around his collar and his sleeves, and then he rips it off, and he still has something underneath of it. You've got black shirt underneath. If I ripped my shirt off right now, I'd be like naked.
That's the Pluto police. The Pluto police are coming for you.
I've uncovered the secret.
The thing is, Patrick, you live in a country where it's like, 34 degrees is like normal, right? I live in a country, where 34 degrees is like a really hot fucking summer. I'm used to like 12 degrees centigrade,
Have you ever noticed how some people, when they get drunk, are maybe more touchy-feely, or more some other way, some other guys.
I just got to say right here. You know what I mean? I just got to say, Cyprian, America has already agreed that gay people can get married. That touchy feely thing, we've dealt with that. We're done with that. No more touchy feely stuff. Okay.
Wow,
I don't want to say one word.
Extremely drunk individual.
I guess we can cope with it for 5 more minutes.
I only have one word for that. Terci. The word is berserk.
I am a berserker, and when I go into these games where I have to go into deep dungeons and chop things, I am the berserker. I chop and kill.
You watch me play.
Hold on a minute.
I chop and kill and shoot and murder and eat flesh, human flesh.
I used to be the one that was, now I know how people feel when I'm in their rooms.
That's crazy.
Stizer, hold on, wait a minute. Everybody needs to stop. Stizer is
empathy. Roy.
Shut up.
I have never seen Stizer empathy. This is a breakthrough.
Yeah.
This is a breakthrough.
That's it. I'm going to an AA meeting this week. Fuck that shit.
You're gonna have to. Stizer does not empathize. Welcome, bro Joe.
We all know that.
Oh, by the way, guys, if you Brother John hosts a morning show, it's called the Morning Crow? You changed the fucking names. It is the Morning Crow, isn't it?
I've got to say, Stizer, you know me as well. I mean, I've been acting like the crazy, crazy man.
I'm fucking crazy.
Yeah, I'm a sophisticated, well-educated person. I can talk on several levels about different kinds of things.
So you say.
I'm not the crazy.
When he's not rat assed, it's okay. When he's rat assed, it sounds just
like. Even if rat assed, I can. If you can say to me, James, you've said too much. Shut up and let somebody else talk. I will shut down and let somebody else talk. It's just, we've got to get to that level of talking to each other on, you know, on understanding each other's, you know.
Well, we've had a really, I will say this, so everybody shut the fuck up, apart from Joseph, who's allowed to fucking intervene whenever he wants. But in the sense of today's show, it's a really good show. Because I didn't get the chance to, I want to thank Ozymandias for showing up. It was a really interesting. And also Christopher Malty for showing up, even though I only seen like 2 seconds of him in the room.
He asked a pretty boss question and made a few cool comments.
We'll have them back on eventually. But we will have a crazy guest hopefully next week. A good crazy guest next week.
Somebody a little more Looney Tunes.
No, we're gonna have the Pillbox on the show next week. Actually,
that's Looney Tunes.
Yeah, the Pillbox will be showing up, and we're gonna talk about evolution.
You're not going to talk about evolution.
Yes, we will.
There are no transitional fossils.
This is the point. I told him. I gave him fair warning. I said, look,
of anything, and somehow it's going to go into abiogenesis.
He's going to put his ideas across, but not even going to.
Big Bang and. God did it.
He's just going to give his ideas.
God did it.
All right, listen. Beyond the bullshit, listen. You understand that the Earth is fucking flat, right?
When you're in an airplane, you don't see the curvature of the Earth. No. You only think you see the curvature of the Earth.
And chemtrails rule, and yeah, really. You never landed on the moon, and
fuck.
Yeah, but we're gonna have Pillbox on next week's show, hopefully, if he shows up. But I give him his credit, right? Pillbox did say he will show up, so we'll see. If not, then we'll change guests. But hopefully next week we'll have Pillbox.
I hope what I just was doing doesn't discourage him, because I'm just playing around. It's just all in good fun.
Like I said, I give him credit for saying he will come on the show, so yeah. If he can make it, then that would be a really interesting show as well. Yeah. And thank you for the
questions about his flat Earth thing that I just saw on the internet.
Yes. The Earth is flat when you're looking at your feet.
If you're in an airplane.
Yeah. Even though there's a big curve.
No, that's an illusion, bro. I just told you.
Yeah, I'm sorry, dog. It's all this New Age science shit. It's all this NASA shit and Pluto. Yeah. It's got me all confused and shit, you know?
It's just a bullshit that they try to pull over our eyes.
Yeah, like NASA's a big conspiracy theory shit.
Yeah, like the Earth is round, like a sphere.
Like, I've just been listening to guys with... Yeah, I've just been listening to guys with like PhDs talk about like, wow, you know, the galaxy's got a halo.
But seriously, Stye and Beyond the Bullshit, did you ever get anywhere with that stuff that we were supposed to be doing on Beyond the Bullshit?
Yeah, we are, but we're taking it slow. That's all. We're just making sure.
Don't gotta worry about all that just yet.
I myself taking just sip by sip.
Because you know, I'm still interested in
off air.
Yeah. Okay. Anyway, yeah, it's actually time to go off air. So thank you for everybody who watched. It the room's still open, so if you want to come in and just chat shit, you're welcome to.
Yeah, you missed your portion to be on the air. In case you wanted to be on the air, we're going off air.
Yeah, we're
going off air.
So
fuck you.
So big thanks to Ozymandias. Just a Malty as well, who I just think is cool. So big thanks to Ozzy, and big thanks to my co-host over there, Mr. Hat himself. Mr. Joseph.
The Mad Hatter, the Chocolate Rainbow, Hold by Unicorn. Oh, whatever.
Alright. So make sure you subscribe. Guys, I just want to make this point clear. This channel is new, so you guys need to subscribe or you won't get any updates, and we're basically just too fucking lazy.
And we have to keep struggling to send out the link, which is very inconvenient when
so if you like the show, subscribe and all that good stuff. And we'll try and make it as entertaining and thoughtful as possible and try and go beyond.
I've been trying to fucking go out. I mean, can you give me a minute?
I don't need to do shit. Shut up. Let me finish my outro. He's still shouting. How funny is that? Peace out.